It is Football Fridays in Georgia. Tonight, GPB is live in Milton, Georgia for an epic Region 5 6A battle between the Milton Eagles and the Walton Raiders. Good evening, everybody. I'm Trey McDaniel alongside Keelan Johnson. Keelan, it's hard to believe there's just 3 weeks to go in the regular season.
Yes.
These two teams tonight are in a dogfight to try to make the postseason, and they both want to do it by running the football. Let's spotlight the running backs, and let's start with K.K. Brooks for the Raiders.
Yeah, K.K. Brooks does so many great things for this Raider football club. He does a lot of things out the backfield in the passing game. He does great things for them, especially in the running game too as well, getting north, south, east, west running back. He's electrifying. Another thing that coaches really love about him, he's a sponge. He brings everything in. He takes it all in. To be so young, he does so much for them, and that's why they like him.
Now, Milton is without their star running back, Trayvon Polk, but Chad Toliver has stepped in very well. Talk about the young man.
Yeah, Chad Toliver is the one guy that you guys want to make sure you lock your eyes in on tonight. He brings so much to the table on the offense side of the ball. He's a north-south runner. He does not go down on the first sight of contact. This young man is going to be a quiet to see tonight.
And we're going to be having kickoff in a few minutes. We can't wait for this game to start, but let's send it over to our sideline reporter, John Nelson. Nelly?
Thank you, Trey and Keelan. Good evening. However you are watching us this evening, whether it's on GPB TV, GPB.org, or through our app. This time of year, folks like to talk about statements, delivering statements, and there are certain ways to deliver them. There are certain ways maybe not to deliver them. Look what was delivered today to the Milton Fieldhouse, to the Milton Eagles. Rest in peace tonight. Walton rules. Those kinds of things are motivational on a lot of different levels, and let's see what kind of motivation the two teams are going to need as we look at the region standings. Right there in the middle of the table, the three-way tie for first, Etowah, Lassiter, Walton. Milton knows that these next games of theirs are necessary. If they're going to make the playoffs, they've got to be at the top of the ladder and get into that mix below Roswell and Cherokee. Make sure that there's some separation, because right now there are six teams chasing after four spots when it comes to the four playoff spots in this particular region. We will have highlights and all the talk about everything else that's going on around the state. We'll let you know how the playoffs are shaping up. So Trey and Keelan, let's light this candle. It's going to be another busy night here on Football Fridays.
Thank you so much, John, and we'll get right to our keys to success brought to you by the Georgia Peanut Commission. Peanuts, the power-packed snack for the big game. Keelan?
Well, first and foremost, Walton really has to get vertical in their passing game tonight. They really like to run those street passes. They have to go vertical in order to win this football game. On the defense side of the ball, they have to win a one-on-one matchups across the front line. You have to be able to get off those blocks and get penetration to the quarterback. And as for Milton on offense, the offense has to keep the defense on their heels. Quick game, quick count. Get this ball moving very fast down the field. Keep them off their heels, all right? And as on defense side of the ball, they have to get pressure off the edges. Their defensive ends have to have the best game of their life.
You take a look at Coach DeCristofaro. He's been somewhat of a turnaround artist and a heck of a coach down in Florida. And Keelan will talk about him a lot tonight because you guys both come from the same area down in Florida. But he's 16-13 here as the Milton coach. He's the only coach so far in Milton history, which dates back to the 50s, that has a winning record. He's doing very well. And, of course, Coach Rocky Hidalgo on the opposite sideline. He's just 2 years removed from being the runner-up in the 6A classification, a phenomenal 38-16 record. But as they stated in our open tonight, it's a very young team. They're searching for consistency, and they've won the toss, and they've elected to receive.
Both of these coaches bring so much intensity. As we talked to them over the phone this week, Trey, they bring so much intensity with their voices and the way they coach. This is a must-win for both teams. Expect to see a lot of hitting, a lot of free calling as far as on the offense side of the ball, plays that they normally wouldn't run. It's a must win tonight for both teams.
You see the series history. Walton has won the last 13 meetings. The Milton Eagles are very hungry for a victory, and they sure need it. They've yet to get their signature win of the season. It could come tonight. Back deep to receive is Clay and DJ Smith. Kick goes into the end zone as it normally does, off the foot of Jordan Genovese. It'll be first and 10 from the 20-yard line for the Raiders. And leading the Raiders is Price Wilson, the senior quarterback and the offensive leader. Good stats so far this season, almost 1,500 yards through the air, 13 touchdowns, and only 3 interceptions. He is their leader, and as he goes, so goes the offense here for the Walton Raiders.
The most important thing on that list there, Trey, is three interceptions. As a leader of your football club, you do not want to be responsible for turnovers, and then he's the key to their offense.
They come out immediately in the pistol formation. And we'll have a flag before we even have a play from scrimmage. Dead ball, false start. You see your officials there. Keith Collis, the head referee. And as we say at the beginning of every game, Keelan, I hope he's not a very busy man tonight.
Yeah, you don't want to get these flags going. You know, it's kind of cold out here tonight. I'm sure everybody's ready to go home in a nice, reasonable hour.
So they'll back him up 5 yards, first and 15. Back to the pistol formation, and K.K. Brooks standing behind Wilson, and that's Clay in motion. And here goes K.K. Brooks, and a nice early run up to the 24-yard line, a 9-yard gain on first down. And take a look at the offense for the Walton Raiders, brought to you by Regions Bank. The only returning starter on the O-line is Eric Smith, number 64. They've got some skill at the skill positions. Keep your eye on K.K. Brooks and Chad Clay. Chad Clay comes in for the injured Maurice Gibson.
This offense can do so many things. It has so many skilled guys that can play running back, they can play slot receiver. A lot of guys going both ways on the side of offense and defense.
And they go play action to Clay. And the aforementioned Clay is streaking down the middle of the field and into Milton territory and down just shy of the 25-yard line. And that's what the Walton Raiders like to do. They run the ball and then they go play action, 50 yards and a big first down.
Yeah, this defense was in the quarter defense. Number two receiver goes right up the side, right up the middle of the defense. Someone missed their read. They need to get that play call in check on the defense side of the ball. They want to get this game as a win.
You take a look at Chad Clay, 24 receptions, 4 touchdowns on the season. He is the de facto leading receiver with the head injury. Maurice Gibson, their leading receiver, is out, and Clay has done a wonderful job this season. And here is K.K. Brooks, gets a nice block by Rowling, but he's wrapped up in the backfield. You take a look at the Milton Eagle defense. They're big up front. Nick Anderson, Michael Collins at the end positions. Talent at the linebacker core. Charlie Fault is their leading tackler. And the safety positions, Jordan Parisian and Chase Polkow, also very good.
Had an opportunity to talk with Coach, and he talked about this Milton defense. He said last week you really got exposed, had a lot of missed tackles, a lot of blown coverages. And as you can see right here on this drive, the secondary is not under control here. There's a lot of miscommunication we have back there.
And there's DJ Smith on the pass in the flat. He's very dangerous with the football. He also starts on the defensive side. You'll hear a lot of number 21 tonight as he checks out after the nice catch.
It's getting some ISO out there. Just the receivers blocking out in front for Mr. DJ Smith.
You see DJ Smith rushing and receiving. He's quite a weapon. 10 receptions, 12 carries for 57 yards and a touchdown. And it's a third down play here for Walton. Bunch formation. K.K. Brooks, the deep back. They give it to Brooks off tackle to the right side, and he picks up the Raider first down.
As you can tell, you're going to see DJ on the offense side of the ball and the defense side of the ball tonight. All SEC guy, ACC guy. Talk about this offense running that pistol. The pistols give you so many options. You can run the option out of it. You can run the veer out of it. You can also run some traps with your fullback. And you also can run the ISO, as you saw on that last play.
Same formation with the fullback to the right side this time, and same play to the opposite side. And a nice second effort by K.K. Brooks turns nothing into a 2-yard gain.
As we talk about these defensive ends setting the edge there, as you can tell, they just forcing your will linebacker snap, just make forcing the running back to cut back inside.
Nice play there by number 44, the outside linebacker, Christian Keeney. And Corte Sapp as well, the linebacker. They go empty here on second down. Roughly 7 to go, 2 receivers to each side this time. And we've got another flag. And it's actually going to be a timeout by Walton. As you can tell how big this initial drive is for Coach Hidalgo after the big 50-yard pitch and catch to Clay. They desperately want to win this football game, and they want the exclamation point to score on their first drive. Let's take a look at Walton's resume. It's a good one. Finalists back in 2011. That's easily their best season. They've made the semis in 84, 2004 before that. Seven region titles, Keelan, including five in the last 9 years. Here's the big stat, 34 college signees since 2008, and they are a perennial playoff team, which is why they want to keep that streak going and win this football game. They are pretty much assured of a playoff spot if they can get the victory. If not, it could be an uphill battle.
You can definitely see what Walton has going on the offense side of the ball tonight. They're doing a lot of mixing and matching. Nice run pass balance there. Brooks, four carries, 15 yards. Wilson, two for two for 56 yards in passing through the air. This is the seventh play of this drive.
They come back out after talking about it in the same formation. Four wide, empty backfield on second down and seven. Wilson surveying the field, and he's just going to pull it down and carry it. He's inside the five and dives toward the goal line. And they give him the touchdown. Price Wilson, 14 yards. He's known for his arm, and he just strikes first blood with his legs.
You definitely have to give credit to Price Wilson. Milton did a great job by lining up in quarters right here. He had nobody open, but he decided to run the football in with his feet to get the 6 points on the board. Good job by Price Wilson, the leading quarterback.
Christian Lucas to attempt the point after. Kick is up and good, and Walton is up 7-0 on their first possession of the game. It's a 14-yard run by senior quarterback Price Wilson, and the Raiders are off to a good start on Football Fridays.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is made possible in part by Regions Bank. It's time to expect more. Georgia's Electric Membership Corporation, lighting the way. Technical College System of Georgia, learn more, earn more. And by viewers like you, thank you.
On Nova, how far down the temperature scale can we go?
A billionth of a degree above absolute zero.
When things get very cold, strange things start to happen.
It's levitating.
The future of personal transportation right here.
Making stuff colder.
On Why Wednesday at 9, only on GPB.
Walton jumps out to a 7-0 lead after their first possession and gets set to kick it away to the Eagles for the first time tonight. Here's another look at the touchdown, Keelan. A guy not known for his legs has a nice nose for the end zone here.
Yeah, 1,000-yard passer here with his arm, but decided to take it in with his feet today on the seventh play, 80 yards. Like you said, one thing I really like what he did, he took his time on his drive. He ate 3 minutes and 36 seconds off the clock. That's what you really want. Paying attention to detail, you have to have that from your leader of this team.
Scoring drive brought to you by TCSG and Christian Lucas. In to kick the ball off, back deep to receive is Toliver. Chris Papura also back there, standing at his own 7-yard line. And it's out of bounds. We'll get a flag. And we'll get our first look of the night at the Milton offense, an offense that wants to run the football.
Not only do they run the football, they want to run it down your throat. That's something that this team, they take pride on, losing their starting running back, going to Tennessee. They're going to honor his scholarship, something I really was excited to see, that Tennessee is going to honor his scholarship, allow him to continue to go play football for that good university in the SEC. But having a running back has to step in last minute and Toliver to take over the running duties for this football team. He's been doing a pretty good job at it. His team used to see someone carrying the ball 30 times a game here, Trey. Now, Toliver, he's just not, he's the coach said he's just not in shape just yet to carry the 30 times a game, but he can give you a good 15 to 20 times a game.
He's going to get a chance to return this kick as well, as they've opted for the re-kick. It's a good old-fashioned do-over, Keelan.
Hey, got to take the yardage, man. Like I said, one thing at Georgia that I absolutely despise when it was an offsides on the kickoff. I only got 3 or 4 plays as a freshman and sophomore in the football game, and I took pride in the kickoff. I wanted to run down the field as fast as I can, but anytime somebody was offsides, I had to go back and do it again. I was super tired, baby.
Especially on a cold night here in the middle of October. It's a better kick by Lucas this time, but it will be fielded by Toliver at his own 1 yard line. And watch out, the kid can run, and he looks for the sideline, picks up a nice block, and he crosses into Walton territory. And he might go all the way, and he does. Toliver, touchdown, Milton, 99 yards.
Not only does he go 99 yards, Trey, but he goes 99 yards after a do-over kickoff. And now he's just going to walk right to the sideline and take his place on the bench. Grab some Gatorade. All right, defense, it's on you guys.
Chad Tolliver's second kickoff return touchdown of the season comes at a huge moment against their rival and knots this one up at 7 apiece. Here's your TCSG touchdown replay. It's a spectacular one.
We just finished talking about this young man and how he's taking over the duties at the running back position, but he also has responsibilities on the special team aspect of this team. Nice blocking out in front. Really, 2 or 3 people touched him. That's what talks about the talent that he brings to this deep, to this offense. The holes, the visions, the speed, it all works hand in hand. Great job by Mr. Toliver.
Get the ass together. Come on, man.
Chad Toliver has yet to touch the ball out of the offensive backfield, but he makes his impact felt immediately with 8:08 to go in the first quarter. This game's knotted up at 7 apiece, and the excitement builds here in Milton, Georgia.
You talk about Friday Night Lights, Trey, and you talk about, you know, we was talking about discussing the cold, and it's going to get cold as the game go on, but it suddenly gets a little warm in the atmosphere after nice back-to-back touchdowns by both teams. All right, everybody's woken up now. Now you know you got yourself in a dogfight.
Some call the kickoff return for a touchdown the most exciting play in football, and it makes back-to-back weeks now here on GPB's Football Fridays
yes.
that we've seen kickoff returns. It was Torrance McGee last week for North Cobb and Chad Toliver tonight for the Milton Eagles, and now the Eagles will kick it away for the second time tonight. Genovese kicks it away, and this one goes out of bounds, and it's another flag. No return for DJ Smith.
Now, the same thing happened on the previous kickoff. I wanted the coach going to say, hey, kick it over again and give our guy a chance to take one back to the house. And it's very, 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 very good job by Coach D by just making sure that, you know, giving his team a chance. It's heads up. He knows that his back is kind of against the wall. It's a must win. Hey, he needs more and more opportunities to give his team chances to get out in the forefront of this region.
That's a great point. He could have opted for the yards and just taken it first down and 10 as Walton is at the 35-yard line. Instead, he gives Toliver a chance. And it turns into 7 points for the Eagles, and now their defense is back on the field, and we've got another stoppage. It'll be a timeout for the Eagles. It's another great season of Georgia Traveler this fall on GPB. Watch David Zelski and the crew as they uncover more of the hidden Georgia that may be across the state or around the corner. It's Georgia Traveler this Sunday at 7 o'clock, only on GPB. But right now on GPB, it's Football Fridays in Georgia, and it's 7-7 here in Milton. And Walton looked very good on their first possession, Keelan, and they get their second crack at it here tied at 7 apiece.
One thing I really like how posed Mr. Price was standing in the pocket, making the right checks, giving his receivers the nice touchable balls and catchable balls.
K.K. Brooks right side on the toss sweep. Tackle made by number 57, Ryan Canso.
One thing Coach Rocky was concerned about going into this football game, we asked him about his offensive line. He was really kind of just, you know, he wasn't fired up about the offensive line. He said, we're not playing well at all. And he know this is a game that they have to pay attention to the detail. They have to work on their hand placement. They have to work on their calling. They're getting the right checks and scraping to the next level because they have to create those lanes for Mr. Brooks, and they've been doing a good job of that tonight so far.
K.K. Brooks finds his own lane on second down and gets awfully close to a first down. He needed to get to the 45-yard line, and they'll spot it right on the 45-yard line.
You can see him there just setting up the outside linebackers, faking them out, cutting them back up, going north-south.
K.K. Brooks will check out here on the first down play. Brooks, 6 carries, 25 yards here in the early going. And if Walton is able to establish the run, it could turn into a long night for the Eagles. Ben Hood checks in as the tailback behind Wilson. And here is Ben Hood trying to bounce outside. He's got some room and gets inside of Eagle territory and is taken down there by Nick Steinhaus, the defensive tackle.
You talk about electrifying play, Mr. Hood, their starting cornerback, young guy on the defense side of the ball, coming in, taking over the running back duties to give Mr. Brooks a breather there. As you can see him coming off the edge, the fullback getting there and making a nice block by Mr. Rowling there, giving this guy some lanes to work with.
Coach Hidalgo didn't mince words. He said fullback number 30, Henry Rowling, has been the most consistent player on the team. And so far tonight, he's doing a great job creating holes for the two tailbacks. Second down and short now for Walton. And it's play action again. They're going for the long ball. It's Clay. And the pass sails incomplete. Tremendous coverage by strong safety Eric Peterson.
That's a very, very nice play by the defensive back, just making sure that not getting beat by the play-action pass, keeping his eyes in the right place, keeping his eyes on the hips of the receiver, and actually just making a nice effort to almost intercept the football. Sometimes you got to sell out, Trey, and make that play.
And little extracurriculars, you see how fired up Coach Hidalgo is, not happy with his player. It's a personal foul after the play was over, and they'll back it up 15 yards. It was going to be second down and 3, very manageable for this offense. And now after the penalty, it should be second down and 18.
These are the plays, if you're Milton's defense, you have to be beware of screens. You know, these are the downs you got to beware of, screens and trickery plays, because they have to make up some yardage. And it's third down.
Henry Rowling, the lone back, as he stands in front of Price Wilson as the fullback. And he goes straight to the air on second down and long. He has all day to throw and tries to connect with Clay there. And he is hit, big time hit there by number 14, Corte Sapp, the 6'3", 200-pound junior. A young man that's getting recruited by everybody under the sun. And I guess he's a big hitter too, Keelan.
Yes, he definitely is a big hitter. And this is the reason why he's got so many offers from the ACC and the SEC. This young man has a nose for the football, playing the wheel position. Great job. And a great defensive stop by Milton's defense.
So the personal foul hurt Walton big time there as they will punt the ball away. Hutton Spittler kicks the ball away, and it's touchdown at the 30-yard line. Let's head downstairs to John Nelson. Nellie?
All right, guys, here we go with election coverage starting off in Region 1-6A and the 100th meeting tonight between Colquitt County and Valdosta. Colquitt County with an early 3-0 lead. You look at the rest of the region right now, there could be some action going on down low. Camden's playing Brunswick. Brunswick's always a tough team to play, tough place to play in Brunswick. Also, Tift and Lowndes going at it tonight. John Reed has put the pedal down, and in only 2 years right now has Tift 4-4 as a team, 1-3 in region, but if they get the win tonight on Lowndes, that could make that whole bunch go up together. So you're talking about Region 1-6-8 going back into the blender if some things go with the lower seeds tonight. Swamp War right now, clinch leading Charlton 6-0 first quarter. More in a bit.
And Keelan with 5 minutes and 37 seconds to go in the first quarter. That was the first play from scrimmage for the Milton offense, and it was a handoff to their fullback, Miko Brisker.
Yeah, they believe so much in this guy. They want to make sure that they get north-south very quick. And this is somebody who they rely heavily on, especially in the passing game with protection and also in the running game as well.
Here's Austin McLeod, the signal caller. And take a look at the offensive starters for the Milton Eagles, brought to you by Regions Bank. They're big up front. Keep your eye on Nick Wilson. He's rated as the number two rated junior guard in the United States. And Zach Spezio is their leading receiver. And Chad Toliver, you've already seen what he can do in the kick game. He's a pretty darn good tailback as well. There's number 51, Nick Wilson, being looked at by Georgia Tech, North Carolina, Ole Miss, and a nice play in the backfield by Jordan Davenport. And here is the Raider defense. It's a 3-4 look. Drayon Williams and Kyle Whitaker, the defensive ends, have been the leaders. Davenport there, you just saw him make a tackle. Imani Williams, the guy that Coach Hidalgo calls the ghost because he's just showing up and making tackles all over the place. And then DJ Smith and Takar Stewart both moved from cornerback last year to take over the safety duties for the Raider defense. And punting for the first time tonight is Milton, and it's Matt Moskowitz. And it's taken by DJ Smith at the 35-yard line. So the teams exchange punts, and now Walton will get another crack at it, a 41-yard punt by Moskowitz.
Coach Rocky also talked about the sophomores in his program. He talked about this is the most sophomores ever in school history to play and start at the same time. And just to let you know where this program came from. It's put like a lot of success, a lot of guys going to the next level. Now he's having to retrain his program, rethink his program to make sure he keeps that tradition going.
There you see Trip Allen, the offensive coordinator, searched through his car on the way here and couldn't find a right glove and a left glove, so he's got on two left-handed gloves. He's a little quirky, I can say that, because I love him. His dad was an assistant coach at Brookwood, Ray Allen, one of my favorite coaches of all time, and Tripp's not a bad one himself. Hidalgo told me a couple years ago that he thinks he's got a hidden gem and perhaps the best offensive coordinator in the state. You see that extra thumb hanging out the glove there.
And Coach Rocky said, well, that's one extra play he needs to keep in the chamber.
Second down and 5. K.K. Brooks, right side, trying to bounce it outside, but he can't. Nice tackle made there by Charlie Fault, the middle linebacker, as he busts through for the TFL.
That's a very, very nice play. As you see the linebacker just coming straight downhill. That's a football tackle there, man. Coach talked about Charlie Fault, how he's one of those Friday night football players. He's not going to play at the next level. He's one of those guys, when you turn on the lights on Friday night, you're going to see some good football and some good tackling by Mr. Fault. As you can tell right there, he's right place at the right time to make that big-time play for a TFL tackle.
That was a great shot by our camera crew. Textbook play by the middle linebacker. Third down and long after the tackle for loss. Three wide receivers to the near side. Wilson back to throw. This time he doesn't have quite as much time, but he completes the pass near the 50-yard line to Bailey Wolf.
That's a very, very nice pass by staying in the pocket by Mr. Price there. Nice pressure by Tyler Watson. And you see Mr. Wolf just coming out of nowhere making the play. That's what you got to have by your receiver, by coming back to the ball. As you can see him not waiting, he takes that ball. Very, very nice tech books. Nice pressure. by Mr. Tyler Watson.
And there is Bailey Wolf's numbers on the year, 18 catches for 260 and two scores. It's good enough for a first down at the 49-yard line. That's Clay in motion, and Milton's defense jumps into the neutral zone. That'll be a five-yarder.
The number one play a lot of people do not talk about in football is the silent count, the hard count. When the offense want to get a few extra yards with those 5 yards matters. And it gets if the defensive lineman, your defense is trying to anticipate the snap count, and the quarterback gets up under the center, or he's very loud and he's very aggressive in the snap count, the D lineman jump, and that's 5 yards added on.
The penalty moves the ball inside Eagle territory. And throwing down the field for Bailey Wolf again is Price Wilson, this time. It's broken up by Lucas Nedza, number 20, the junior cornerback.
Very, very nice play by the cornerback coming up, staying aggressive, not giving the receiver no room to catch that one. The ball was kind of high. Mr. Price didn't set his feet in time enough. The ball just sailed on him.
The Raiders passing a lot here in the first quarter. K.K. Brooks has checked back in on second down and four, and he tries the edge again. Escapes one tackler and bulldozes another at the 37-yard line. It's good enough for another Walton first down. Nice to see the sophomore lower his shoulder a bit.
Coach D talked about going into this football game for his Milton's defense. Now they averaged 75 yards per game on rushing, and that's pretty good when you talk about holding the team 75 yards of rushing on the year. Tonight, this team has been doing a great job. Walton's doing a great job on offense by keeping patient and finding the right holes by Mr. Hood and Mr. Brooks.
And the Raiders rush to the line of scrimmage and then check the sideline for the call. Eagles defense threatens blitz, but Price Wilson gets rid of it again to Wolf. This time he looked like he had connected with him, but it's incomplete as the ball hit the ground as they've looked for Wolf three times on this drive.
Yeah, Wolf just couldn't come down with the ball and put his feet in bounds at the same time. That hand-eye coordination, Price put a little zip on that football too as well. As you can see on this drive, they're relying heavily on Mr. Wolf, who's averaging 14.4 yards per catch with two touchdowns on the season.
Second down and 10 after the incompletion. And there's that look again with Clay going in motion from right to left. KK this time again trying to turn it inside, and the young man's done a good job tonight making something out of nothing. He picks up 2 yards.
A tough 2 yards at that there, Trey. He does a great job of making sure he's staying low, keeping that pad level low, keeping his feet moving. He hasn't been tackled tonight on the first tackle. That's a great sign of a running back, shedding those tackles off of him to keep downhill.
Third and seven now. Wilson looking over to the sideline once again to his OC to get the call. Brooks remains in as the tailback. And Wilson looking immediately to his right and short arms it out in the flat. He was looking for DJ Smith. It's incomplete. The offense is kind of in no man's land, but it looks like they're going to bring the punt team in.
As you can see, this Milton defense is just hunkering down, realizing, hey, they got themselves in a big-time game tonight. And Coach told me before the game, he said, hey, look, Keelan, we're going to run some zone. We're going to mix in some cover two in here, too, as well.
It was my mistake, Keelan. They're going to attempt a 50-yard field goal.
Okay.
As Christian Lucas comes in, he has made a 50-yarder on the season earlier in out-of-region play against Hillgrove. And it's a fake. And look at the kicker trying to pick up the first down. He gets nowhere close. Nothing lost, nothing gained for the Walton offense, but a big pick-me-up for the Milton D. It's Jordan Parisian coming up from his safety position to knock the field goal kicker to the ground.
You talk about a little less miles action here. Jordan Parisian staying at home, coming up in the B-line. You can see him right there in the bottom of your screen making the tackle. Number 44 in there on the tackle too as well. Kristen Keeley, nice defensive play. by Milton's defense by staying home.
You think Christian Lucas is headed over to the sideline to say, Coach, let's not do that again. Here's Toliver trying to find the edge, and does. Boy, can that kid run. Nice stiff arm and down the sideline. Looking for the end zone again. Another stiff arm, and he's out of bounds inside the 10. My, oh, my, Chad Toliver.
I just became a fan, Trey. I just became a friend. I think I'm a groupie now. This young man brings so much to the table for this football club. He does it on special teams. And I believe for the fourth time, he touched the ball tonight. He takes another one for a big yardage. Stiff-arming multiple guys in this defense. He's relentless. He's relentless with his stiff arms, and he's definitely relentless with his vision. Good job by Mr. Toliver.
First down and goal. Toliver, again, trying to bounce outside, but he's tripped up, possibly tripped over his own offensive lineman. Center Tyler Perry was in the area, and they may have gotten their legs tangled.
So I think he was a little anxious. He saw the end zone, and his feet just didn't want to catch up with his eyes.
Inside of 10 seconds to go in the first. We'll see if they try to run another play. Coach looks like he's holding them up. That should be the last play of the first quarter. It's been an exciting one. A 99-yard kickoff return for Toliver. You just saw a 56-yard run a moment ago. Three carries for 52 yards for the young man. Don't go anywhere. Second quarter coming up after this from Milton in a huge region rivalry on GPB. It's Football Fridays, everybody. Don't go anywhere.
The wheels of progress haven't been very active lately. But because of business people like you, things are beginning to get rolling. And Regions is here to help, making it easier with the expertise and service to keep those wheels turning. From business loans to cash management, we want to be your partner moving forward. Let's get going together.
Nothing prepares you better for a great career than the 25 colleges of the Technical College System of Georgia. TCSG colleges produce graduates with the knowledge and training today's top employers are looking for. With campuses across Georgia, state-of-the-art facilities, and outstanding instructors with real-world experience, it's the kind of affordable college education that will fast-track you into a rewarding career. We're building a better future for you. Contact the TCSG college in your area today or go to tcsg.edu.
As the demand for power grows,
Georgia's nonprofit, member-owned electric cooperatives
are committed to providing safe,
affordable,
and reliable electricity
to our members.
We've been dedicated
to building strong
communities
for more than 70 years
and are proud to join
the Georgia High School Association
and Georgia Public Broadcasting
in support of our state's student athletes.
We are Georgia EMC, lighting the way.
Think all that homework won't lead to anything? If you're a Georgia high school student, you can enter GPB's video contest, win $1,000, and make a difference.
Did you mean to throw this away?
How can you help stop the drop?
One of my favorite moments from last year was our very first broadcast at the Corky Kell Classic. The special teams unit rushes the field with no timeouts.
Will they have enough time? The snap, the hold, the kick is up. It looks good, and it is good!
Makes a 33-yard field goal.
What a way to start the season. They were a huge underdog.
North Gwinnett upsets Colquitt County, and that really set the tone for a very exciting 2012 football season. Go online and tell us what your favorite moment is.
Class of 2000.
start of the second quarter in Milton, Georgia, 7-7, and the Milton Eagles are threatening thanks to the running ability of Chad Toliver, who's filling in wonderfully for this young man right here. That's Trayvon Polk. He's been their star running back so far this season, but he's out with a torn ACL. You look at his numbers, 65 carries, 513 yards, 8 touchdowns, and he's heading to play football at the University of Tennessee, which kept his scholarship intact despite the injury.
It definitely, man. That's something that you really love to see. Guys, even after they get injured, you know, that's something that I really worried about, Trey. I tore cartilage in my ankle my senior year playing basketball, and I wasn't sure if Georgia or Troy or Southern Mississippi was going to honor my scholarship after I got hurt. But it's really good to see this young man keep his scholarship, Tennessee honor his scholarship, but they know the potential he has for their program.
Absolutely, and he's got a smile on his face because his team is threatening to take the lead here. It was Miko Brisker carrying the ball on second down and goal. Tackles was made by Zach Williams, and Toliver hasn't done too shabby in his stead.
Oh, no.
And the handoff to Toliver as he tries to sneak into the end zone and can't. He's dropped once again by Zach Williams, the outside linebacker. It brings up fourth down and goal, and a field goal opportunity coming for the Eagles.
Yeah, you get to 3 points here, Trey.
Jordan Genovese, a good kicker, 6 of 8 field goals on the season. His long has been 42 up to this date. This is a 22. It is up and good, and the Eagles have reclaimed the lead with 10:45 to go in the second quarter. Let's head downstairs for the first time tonight with our social media correspondent, Grace Olson. Grace?
Thanks, Trey. Big night of Walton-Milton football here at Milton Stadium. But I know a lot of you haven't just followed these teams throughout the season. You followed them throughout the year, so our trivia is for you. Tonight we want to know, what was the last year that Milton beat Walton in football? We got a couple hints for you. It was the same year the movie Forrest Gump came out. It was the year Justin Bieber and Conyers native Dakota Fanning were born, and it was also the year that Atlanta hosted its first Super Bowl. Take to Twitter, find us on Facebook, give us the answer. I'll return in the fourth quarter with our trivia winner of the night. Back to you guys up in the booth.
Thank you so much,
wow.
Grace.
Justin Bieber was born that year? Yeah, you look at that young man. He seems pretty old now. He's growing up.
Take a look at your scoring drive. 5 plays, 60 yards, 1:59. Brought to you by the Technical College System of Georgia. And Genovese, who just booted through a 22-yard field goal to give Milton the lead, will kick off for the third time tonight. DJ Smith and Chad Clay back to receive for Walton. And into the end zone for a touchback. And now Walton will have to try and answer back from the 20-yard line. And really, they've looked pretty good on offense so far tonight. Keelan, the 15-yard personal foul earlier in the game on offense really stifled what was a good drive up to that point. K.K. Brooks has looked good, and Price Wilson has looked pretty good in the passing game as well.
Yeah, Price Wilson has been doing a really good job of just managing the offense, not really forcing anything. He had a few unthrown and overthrown footballs in the past couple drives, but his running games have been really helping him out.
Been in the shotgun most of the night. K.K. Brooks standing to his right. He'll give it to K.K. Nice spin move. And takes Corte Sapp on a 3-yard ride for a 4-yard gain.
Hey, just a nice touchdown saving tackle. I'm telling you, if Mr. Brooks there had just a few extra inches, Mr. Snap would have definitely wrapped him up for that tackle. This is a very nice spin. And good job by Stapp holding on.
I tell you what, that young man's predecessor, Tyron Jones, had that spin move down, and it looks like the sophomore has it as well. They give Brooks 5 yards on the first down carry. And Wilson straight to the air. DJ Smith trying to get the ball to their playmaker, and he goes nowhere. as number 20, Lucas Nedza, has a hold of his right foot. Let's head downstairs to John Nelson.
You know, you mentioned Tyron Jones, and speaking of Tyron, this is the kind of stuff that he did on Georgia Public Broadcasting. You know, you look at him right here from the Corky Kell, and whoop, there's the spin move as he goes. Little step to the left, step to the right. And we got to showcase him a lot last year as a senior before he was injured. The rest of the season took over. And right now at the University of Alabama, you want to talk about a big backfield. Kenyon Drake from Hillgrove, Tyron Jones, and also Alvin Kamara waiting in the wings to go with McLeod. So Walton is sending a lot of folks to Tuscaloosa, and so is Cobb County.
Absolutely, and hard to believe that number 10 right there is just a sophomore. After this season, he'll have two more years in this offense, and he's really come into his own. Been a real bright spot for this offense that Coach Hidalgo admitted, Keelan, that's been quite inconsistent this season.
Yeah, exactly, man. You can see the talent that Walton definitely has had in the past in the running back position. Even this year with K.K. Brooks coming in with 12 touchdowns on the year so far. They have a bright upside for their program.
And here he is, untouched into the defensive backfield, and a nice 10-yard gain on first down up to the 42 goes K.K. Brooks.
Definitely have to give credit to this offensive line once again. As you can see him getting that push, as you can see right there, number 30 getting out in front, Henry Rowland, one of a very good blocker for him, the most consistent guy on their football team, as you talked about, another young man that's going to University of Georgia to play baseball.
And now the backup comes in, Ben Hood, and he picks up a couple on first down as Brooks gets a breather. And that offensive line that has struggled a bit this year looks like they're functioning as one unit right now. And another nice tackle by middle linebacker Charlie Fault. No wonder he's the leading tackler.
Young man's always around the ball, man. My high school coach has got to be a ball hog. You got to be a ball hog, Johnson. And that's what a ball hog is. Someone's all the way around the football.
Wilson does a nice job retrieving that one off his shoelaces, and then it's tipped at the line of scrimmage incomplete. It'll bring up third down and 8.
Nice tip dive by Grant Pingler on that defensive tackle position. You know, number one job for a defensive lineman is to get penetration and also to get your hands up in the passing lane. And they're doing a good job of that on that play.
Trip Allen's dad, Ray Allen, used to call us Batman in practice when we knock one down like that. And there's Wilson all day to throw. And he finds Clay awfully close to a first down and inside Eagle territory.
It's a nice big time conversion there by Chad Clay coming back to the ball with 14.8 yards per catch coming into this ball game. As you see, Price is keeping alive. That's what you have to do. Keep your eyes downfield, looking off the safeties, and just throwing a dart in the middle of the coverage. And that's how you get down and dirty and get that football as a receiver.
Well, you said it earlier in the game, Keelan, that he looked awfully poised back there, and he certainly did right there. He hands the ball off to Hood on fourth down and 1, and he is short. And the Milton Eagle defense, led by Coach Pete DeWeese, step up big, and they get the ball back on a turnover on downs.
Just a big-time step-up play by this Milton's defense when it matters. As you can see, this defense right here just stepping up, getting some penetration, and look who it is by the football again. Mr. Fault back there getting K.K. Brooks to change, Mr. Hood to change directions to force him back inside where his meat is right there. Nice game tackle by Milton High School.
And the Eagles take over first down and 10 at the 49-yard line. And McLeod airs it out. First time they've tried to go deep tonight, and it's caught somehow at the 10-yard line by Spezio. 43 yards and a huge first down. After the big defensive stop, it's a huge play on offense.
Austin McLeod put everything he had in that pass. He stood in the pocket. Nice protection by his offensive line that you can see. Look at him. He just steps up and nice catch by just undercutting your defensive back there. Ryan Leben, the go-to guy, the deep play guy. He has 22 catches on the year. Played free safety last year, as you can see. He has a nose for the ball, too, as well. number one thing as an athlete, you have to be able to go up and get the ball and keep the ball moving down the field. Good job by Zach.
They'll get the Eagles for a false start on first down and goal, but a wonderful catch by Zach Spezio, the Eagles' leading receiver. That was his 17th catch on the season. And Coach D calls Austin McLeod a game manager, and Austin McLeod's response is, game manager, my fanny. And he just throws it down the field to number 12, and it's first and goal, Eagles. But the five-yard penalty backs him up to the 12.
You talk about the momentum of a high school football game. It's always switching back and forth, back and forth. And I want to say one thing about this Milton's team is doing a great job of making sure they fight for the momentum.
You take a look at Coach DeWeese, the defensive coordinator, and you know Coach D trusts this man because Coach D. Cristofaro said, for my 15 years in coaching, I've always liked to have my thumbprint on the defense, but for the first time, I can turn it over to a guy that I trust to take care of it, and he's doing a fantastic job. It's a big reason why this team is 5-2 right now.
I had an opportunity to come out here last year and to see a few games, and he's a very intensified coach. He loves his players. He meets them out there on the 30-yard line or the 20-yard line after a big turnover, and he jumps up and then just chest bumps his players, man. They respect him a lot. They respond to him a lot. As you can tell, he has their attention. When a player's eyes are looking at his coach's eyes, you can tell they respect, and they're trying to understand what's coming out of his mouth.
A modest one-yard gain on the previous play by Miko Brisker. It brings up third down and goal. Ball spotted at the 8-yard line. Toliver back in. Brisker goes in motion, and a flag comes down in the defensive backfield. And another false start.
The second one
against the Eagles.
Momentum killers have a big-time pass down the field. You have two penalties back-to-back. Sometimes your offensive linemen get anxious. You just can't have those simple mistakes.
So McLeod back in the shotgun here on third down and goal from the 12. Brisker in motion. Play action. Has to get rid of it. Finds Brisker. And then Brisker finds the ground quickly as DJ Smith submarines him at the 7-yard line.
That's an unbelievable play by DJ Smith. He was covering the tight end across the middle. And as you can see, DJ Smith, he coming up, covering the tight end, and he comes off to come downhill to hit the fullback. That's why this guy is going to be a defensive player in the next level.
And Brisker has a point. He didn't think that his knee touched the ground, and nor do I. Let's take a look. His face mask touches.
Yeah, you have an interesting point there, Trey.
As he got back up and ran into the end zone and was pleading his case for a touchdown, instead, Genovese attempting a 25-yard field goal. He's already got a 22-yarder, and that one's good too, and it extends Milton's lead to 13-7 with 4:28 to go before half.
Only if they had instant replay in the high school, Trey.
Don't go anywhere. It's interesting here in Milton.
The German Consulate in Atlanta, encouraging you to study German and to learn more about our diverse culture with much to discover in 2013. More information about Germany as an environmental leader and other current topics on the web at germany.info/Atlanta.
Georgia Peanut Commission, offering Power Pack Georgia Peanuts as a delicious snack and fuel for the big game. Georgia Peanuts are the official state crop of Georgia, with almost half of all peanuts in the U.S. produced by Georgia farmers.
Let's talk about the teams trying to get to the next level.
To 7 Milton after the 25-yard Genovese field goal, and downstairs with some election coverage from John Nelson. Nelly?
All right, guys, thank you very much. We're going to go to Region 7. So as you look at Region 7 and see how things are shaping up right now, You see North Gwinnett at the top of the ladder. There's an issue with that as we're in the second quarter. Collins Hill had a 10-0 lead. Right now they're leading North Gwinnett by the score of 10-7. Norcross and Peachtree Ridge are going at it tonight. Norcross leading that one 7-0. So 1-3 right now, interesting. Equally interesting, 2-4. Mill Creek has some work to do, but right now they're in an off week, so they're just having to watch everything else as the fifth team trying to go for that four spot.
North Gwinnett losing tonight.
Well, remember a couple weeks ago they were losing big to Mill Creek and
came back.
They came back and won with 22 points in the last 6 minutes of the game.
Yeah, I'm telling you right now, man, the number two team in the state's losing right now. The Colquitt County's losing and Camden County's losing, all losing tonight so far.
You see your scoring drive there brought to you by TCSG.
You know, Spire's been a big-time player for that ball club for North Gwinnett, and you know, let's see what he can see if he can bring his ball club back.
Go get it! And DJ Smith gets an opportunity to return it. It hits the ground, but he scoops it back up and can't get back to the 20-yard line. He goes down at the 17, and the Walton Raider offense has some work to do. Down 13-7 with 4:20 to go before half. Let's take a look at Coach D and Keelan, for a change, you've got a guy standing on the sideline, patrolling the sideline, rallying the troops, whatever you want to say,
yeah,
who comes from your neck of the woods, somebody that you can speak to.
Yeah, man, he coached in New Smyrna Beach.
I
went to middle school in New Smyrna Beach, and he also coached at D-Land High School. Both of those schools in Volusia County, where I'm from, where I played football down. And as I was in middle school, he was one of the coaches coaching against my brother, who played at Mainland High School, the school I graduated from. And he was somebody who we always respected, who had a lot of great things going for all those programs. And he brought a lot to the program, of Volusia County, where I was born and raised. And you can see so much vigor in his voice. You can hear it, and you can see the intensity that he has when you talk to him in person. He loves his kids. He has so many sons. And when you coach, you have adopted sons all over the place, man. Kids living all in his house. And his wife is just a beautiful person inside and out. And you can tell so many people come see him in the offseason and spend some time with him. They love their old ball coach, man. They really do.
I tell you, when we got off the phone with him yesterday, I wanted to run through a brick wall. He's a very inspirational character. Has coached weightlifting for some time. Had a state champion daughter at weightlifting.
Yes.
And is an intense character. Nelly knows something about Coach D.
Yeah, you talk about that, and we also had mentioned in the conference call, we wanted to ask him what the differences were when it came to Florida High School and Georgia High School, when it came to the kids and came to the coaching. And I thought that his answer was really interesting. When it came to the athletes, he said that there were more athletes down there per se, you know, on average when it came to both sides of the ball. But the coaching up here and the level of intensity up here was what sets it apart when you're talking about Florida v. Georgia.
Yeah, that's an interesting point there, John, because that's, you know, that's one thing I've noticed also just by my first year on the broadcast with you guys, which I'm having a great time partnering up with Georgia Public Broadcast, is the programs. It's a much better program in the booster clubs, and everybody sticking together and making sure these kids have what they need week in and week out. And you're absolutely right. You know, it's a lot more athletes on the offense side of the ball and the defense side of the ball. But when you talk about the Georgia program, they do a great job in making sure these kids' needs are met week in and week out.
Here's a nice pass from Price Wilson to Chad Clay. Clay already has a 50-yard catch on the night. That one will bring them to within about a yard and a half of a first down. Clay's got 3 catches for 66 yards, but the Walton offense will need one more if they want to move the chains on this drive.
Yeah, they're doing a great job just trying to mix it up. The last couple drives, they haven't had much success in getting into a rhythm.
They'll call encroachment on the Milton defense, and that'll move the sticks so they don't have to pick up the yardage the conventional way. They get the gift.
You mentioned Coach Howie and how he coached lifting up, weightlifting. You know, he has a fullback, number 33, Bresker, who has 7 world records, all right, in the 100-pound, 90-pound weightlifting class. bench press. You have to actually bench press the bar, hold it on your chest, and then punch it up in the air. 325 pounds has a world record in that. Also, he has a world record in deadlifting, 512 pounds. All right. Also has the squatting record of 496 pounds. As you see him right there, number 33. This young man is major, major, major athletic. He does so much for this football club. For someone who has seven world records, he's out here on a football team trying to help his team win. He brings a lot to the table, and that's one of Coach's favorite players.
Wilson airing it out for Wolf, and Wolf having a hard time pulling that ball in tonight. The fourth time he's been targeted in his second drop of the night. And how would you like to have number 33, Miko Brisker, bearing down on you from the fullback position?
Yeah.
You played free safety. You got a world record weightlifter coming at you full steam ahead. I'd get the heck out of the way.
Seven world records at that, too. You know, your man, you look at this guy and see how he's built. Hey, I know we're going to see much of him in the second half to come. But just as look at him to see his size and his features. And also look at the hair coming out of his jersey, too, as well, man. It's pretty a sight to see. It's a nice sight to see.
There's a big third down here late in the second quarter for Wilson. They sprint him out to the right, and he goes deep looking for DJ Smith, the home run hitter. And he pulls it in, and flags go down at the 24-yard line. If it's defensive pass interference, he'll obviously decline it and take the yardage on the catch. And both quarterbacks now have thrown into double coverage with success here in the second quarter.
This is an unbelievable job on offense by the receiver, DJ Smith. He's their big play guy. He's their go-to guy in a time of need. And you look at this play and look at the time going into halftime, 1:36 left in the ball game, and it's 13-7. They need a big play. They need to get the ball in their playmaker's hand, and DJ Smith is definitely that guy for them. 14.4 yards per catch at the wide receiver position for DJ Smith.
And Michael Collins came in after Wilson let her fly and put a nice hit on him. But it's a big first down for the Raider offense. And here is K.K. Brooks trying to find a seam. Does. Cuts down inside at the 15-yard line. Picks up 8-9 yards on first down. Tackle made by strong safety Eric Peterson.
Look at the vision. Look at the lanes. Look at the blocking right there by this offensive line. Getting to the second level. Creating lanes for Mr. K.K. Brooks.
And Wilson finds Clay on the outside.
You can see a very nice play, just something safe. That's a nice speed out to Chad Clay. You look.
First down and goal after the Clay catch, as Walton tries to inch closer or even take the lead here with 1:01 left to go before halftime. Here is Brooks following Rowling into the end zone for the Walton touchdown. 10 yards for K.K. Brooks. And the sophomore is having himself a night, and with the extra point, Walton could take the lead.
You see how important it is to have a guy that you can throw the ball vertical to in a time of need in the 1 minute drill. It was 1:37 left on the clock, and Walton was just throwing up a hope and a prayer. And Mr. ACC and SEC guy going up for it, coming down with the football. DJ Smith moving the chains for his team, making a big time play. It's keeping it alive.
Christian Lucas gives the Walton Raiders the one-point advantage, and here's your Technical College System of Georgia touchdown replay, and look at Rowling blow things up in the middle.
You know, Rowling just coming off the edge, sealing it up, making sure he closed that gap off for his running back. And, you know, I have to say this again. Coach Rocky just said, hey, we're not playing well at all in the offensive front. But I can tell you right now, these guys have stepped up. Look at this, 9 plays, 83 yards, 3:24 off the clock. And this offensive line is a big part of that scoring drive right there, making sure the quarterback Price has time in the pocket. having lanes for K.K. Brooks.
Scoring drive brought to you by Technical College System of Georgia. And Keelan, you can see K.K. Brooks now just 9 yards away from the century mark in one half of football.
I talked to Coach, and when I asked Coach, I said, Coach, you know, you talk about your offensive line. You know, I know you guys are struggling right now, but what are you guys doing during the week? What are you guys doing in practice to make sure you guys get out of that? He said, you know what, Keelan, I don't have any secrets. There's no secrets to our football team. We just work on details. We work on the small things. We work on hand placement. We work on our feet. And I was very shocked and surprised. And that lets you know, we stick to coaching. Our coaches to stick to coaching. And you can see in this game tonight, they're doing a great job of that.
Coming up at halftime, we have the Are You Smarter segment with the school principal, the marching band performances, a social media update from Grace Olson, scores, and a whole lot more. Mark and Claire will have you covered. Right now on the football field, it's 14-13 Walton with 56 seconds to go before the half. Milton with a couple field goals and a kickoff return. And here's the kickoff taken by Purpuro, his first chance of the night. And he'll try the right side, and he'll be taken down aggressively by Christian Sullivan. And an interesting stat so far, Keelan. Walton with 12 first downs in the first half. Milton with just two.
I know you look at the score, 14-13, and that doesn't dictate it. You know, one thing about that, and what Walton has done a good job on offense, they have had long drives. They have run, taken the ball across the 50-yard line, eating the clock up. That's why you can tell. Look at those first downs compared to Milton's first downs.
Dead ball personal foul on Milton. It'll be an uphill battle. And Keelan, I'll ask you this, with the 15-yard penalty coming up and just 50 seconds to go on the clock and two timeouts, what's your offensive philosophy here? Do you try to get some more points before the half, or do you go conservative?
Well, if you look at the type of players that Milton has on the offensive side of the ball, they don't have a lot of athletes at the skill positions, at the receiver and the slot and the tight end. And the only guy that you really have back there is your running game, and that's Chad Toliver. You want to try to get him the ball and try to maybe throw some screens with your fullback or throw some screens to the sideline and bubbles and things of that nature, because 50 seconds with one timeout, two timeouts, that's a long shot.
Defense keying on Toliver that time. Coming in to make the tackle is linebacker Joey Goodman, number 22. Also number 43, Ridge Gibson, in on the tackle. It's actually a loss of one, second down and 11. The clock was running. There's an official timeout on the field. Check us out next Friday with Football Friday's All Access Pass show live at 7 o'clock, followed by the game of the week. We're in DeKalb County at Hallford Stadium, where Tucker welcomes Martin Luther King for a spectacular November game. Georgia Public Broadcasting Sports Football Friday's All Access Pass show, followed by MLK and Tucker. It's the game of the week, November 1st at 7 o'clock, right here on GPB.
That's going to be a good game there, Trey.
Let's take a look at the Milton resume, and not quite as eye-popping as the Walton resume, but Coach D has this moving in the right direction. Only 10-win season came all the way back in 1952. Only playoff win was the next year in 1953. Five winning records in the last 20 years. No coach in school history except Coach D with a winning record. 16-13 is his, but they've had some great players come through here. Sean Bailey, Tony Williams, the talented running back, and of course, Daniel Pope from the NFL.
Yeah, Sean Bailey was one of my teammates at the University of Georgia who took a lot of pride in his program. And one thing about Coach, man, I got an opportunity to spend a little time with him before the game, and he's talking about his family, he's talking about his players and the relationship he has with them. That's why he's able to turn this program around. These kids, you know, dealing with off-the-field issues, dealing with classroom and then coming to practice, it's a lot of pressure on these kids in high school just because of the rivals and just because of the competition level in their region too as well. You know, he does so much for these guys off the field. He does a lot for his coaching staff. That's why these guys are coached well too as well. They spend time, they have their own tailgate at the end of the end zone every home game. It's catered. the coaches' families and kids, the wives, they all get together. And that's why this program is such a tight-knit program, because he cares about them.
Straight up the middle for no gain once again. And with a win tonight, Milton could have back-to-back winning seasons for the first time since 2007-2008. Last year they were 7-4, and they were knocked out of the playoffs in the first round by South Gwinnett, and they lost to this Walton team 27-7. Tonight, it's a close one, 14-13, with about a half minute to go before halftime. Said downstairs to Nelly once again.
Well, we've gone from 1-7. Let's talk about Region 8 6A. And the story of the year right now in probably all of 6A football has to be the team at the top of the ladder in archery. Andy Dyer doing a fantastic job there. If they win tonight, they win the region. So that's the big news out of that one. And right now, Archer was winning. Last report we had, I want to say it was 10-7 second quarter. So you think about what Archer has been able to do. And in their fifth year, their fourth year of a full season, the story of the year right now could be coming out of Gwinnett County with Andy Dyer and the Archer Tigers, guys.
And who would have thought, John, that the 3-4 seed from Region 8 could be a perennial powerhouse team.
Thanks.
Like a Brookwood, and they could be under 500 and make the postseason. Third down for the Eagles. Stuck down inside their own territory, and here's Toliver trying to bounce outside. Runs over the cornerback and goes out of bounds at the 20-yard line.
And you see him there trying to work the edges, trying to get to the sidelines to save some time. Maybe you can get 3 points out of this, but, you know, no passes yet on this drive. I think they're just trying to let this thing run on out.
Let's take a look at the left guard, number 51, Nick Wilson. We talked about him early in the game. You can see him right at the top of your screen, yeah. The number 2 rated junior guard in the country, and you can see why, Keely.
Yeah, definitely does. Has a nice little hoit there, putting his left foot down, anchoring down, nice hand placement, sealing the outside for his running back there. Look at that there, Florida, Georgia, Tennessee, Ole Miss, North Carolina, Maryland, Wake Forest, and Miami. My second favorite football team in America, behind Georgia. He brings a lot to the table. Coaches say this man has a total package, and he gets it done for his ball club.
McLeod will hit a knee and run off the last 30 seconds here before half, and they'll head to the locker room down a point. And the Walton Raiders, who got off to a fast start, regained the lead there in the second quarter. And it's everything we thought it would be here in Milton, Georgia, between two rivals desperately trying to put one in the W column and make it a bit easier to make the postseason in a very convoluted Region 5, 6A. Let's head downstairs to John Nelson. Nelly?
Thank you, Trey, here with the coach. And obviously, you're ruling first downs, but the big plays got you.
We've got to quit making mistakes. We had a personal foul on second and two. You know, we got to convert on some of the short passes. We had some opportunities there, and we didn't connect up. We dropped some balls. I mean, it's kind of we got to get out there and convert those things and quit making those mistakes.
But at the same time, though, this was the kind of dogfight you were thinking it was going to be, though.
They've got a good football team. I knew it was going to be a tough game coming in here. You know, it's a cool night. They're at their place. You know, it's going to be a hard-fought game. This game's not over.
All right, thanks, Rock.
Appreciate it.
All right, let's send it over to Mark Harmon for the best halftime show on this or any other planet, bar none.
Thanks very much, John Nelson. Coming up on Football Fridays in Georgia Halftime, we will preview both bands tonight. John's going to have a preview of next week's big rivalry game between Northside Warner Robins and Warner Robins. We'll also put the principals in the hot seat with Are You Smarter Than Your Students? Grace Olson will check in with some proud parents and the social media world. It's all coming up on the GPB Halftime Show. Right now, Walton leads by 1 point in this big region rivalry, 14-13 over Milton. We're back after this timeout.
As the demand for power grows,
Georgia's nonprofit,
member-owned electric cooperatives
are committed to providing safe,
affordable,
and reliable electricity
to our members. We've been dedicated
to building strong
communities
for more than 70 years
and are proud
to join
the Georgia High School Association
and Georgia Public Broadcasting
in support of our state's student athletes.
We are Georgia EMC, lighting the way.
You have to seize any advantage you can get to build a career even while you're still in high school. That's why the Technical College System of Georgia offers dual enrollment. You earn college and high school credit at the same time, saving you money on college tuition. It's about your future. Dual enrollment jumpstarts your college education and prepares you for work in exciting career fields. Talk to your parents, school counselor, or a TCSG college about dual enrollment, or go to tcsg.edu.
Let's talk about the teams trying to get to the next level.
This is you. You're a Georgia high school student, full of fresh ideas and a desire to make a difference in your school and community. Well, now's your chance. GPB wants you to help stop the drop by showing us why it's important to stay in school. Grab a camera, maybe a friend or two, and create a 30-second video PSA. Why do your peers drop out? What's a solution? All ideas are welcome. Check out the full details at gpb.org/stopthedrop and get going.
On Nova.
Come on in, David.
Standard freezer door.
How far down the temperature scale can we go?
A billionth of a degree above absolute zero.
When things get very cold, strange things start to happen.
Oh, oh! Oh my gosh!
Can we turn our old enemy, the cold, into a force for good?
We're trying to take the emergency out of emergency medicine.
It's levitating.
The future of personal transportation right here.
Making stuff colder.
On Why Wednesday at 9, only on GPB.
Welcome to our holiday Halloween edition of GPB Sports Football Friday's Halftime Show. We are at halftime of the Walton Raiders-Milton Eagles game. It's a good one. 14-13, Walton on top by 1 point. GPB wants to get you involved in the game on the app and online. Let's check in with our social media correspondent Grace Olson with more. Grace?
Thank you, Mark. We've seen a lot of hot pink throughout October to promote breast cancer awareness in the NFL, in college football, in high school football. But tonight here at Milton, we're seeing a ton of purple. This is to promote pancreatic cancer awareness because these guys lost a very important part of the Milton family, the Milton football family, last year. Case, the Braveheart, is here to tell me a little bit about Coach Michael Scott.
Coach Scott, I played for him my first 2 years of high school, my freshman, sophomore year, and he taught me how to bench press and weightlifting, and bench pressing is my favorite workout, which I do a lot. So every time I bench press, I think about him. But obviously, it has a big impact on the team. Last year, when he was battling pancreatic cancer, he passed away around this year, and it was heartbroken to the team. But now this year, we are inspired to fight for him, which is the hashtag Scott Strong.
Okay, now Cole, I wanted to ask you about this hashtag Scott Strong. You guys are number one in my rankings so far this season when it comes to social media. All week long, I've been seeing you tweet with this hashtag Scott Strong, and it's been all over the place. Tell me a little bit about this hashtag. We also have photos of the bracelets and the t-shirts they've been making all week long, and we want to show you those too.
Yes, ma'am. Like the whole, everyone represents Scott Strong, everyone in the whole county. Everyone participates, everyone has respect for Coach Scott, and everyone at school, even if they knew him or not, everyone tries to put forth effort to try to show that they care about what happened to him and his family.
Okay, well, great job promoting awareness for pancreatic cancer and honoring Coach Michael Scott. And I have to ask you before we close it out, are you cold out here tonight?
Oh, no, no. There's a myth that says the Milton Bravehearts do not get cold, and no, we are not cold, I swear to you.
Okay, they say they never get cold. I know we're cold, though. I'm going to send it back over to Mark on the set, who has a heater below his feet.
Grace, great job up there with the fans in the stands. Let's check out the first half highlights right now. Walton leading it by 1 point, 14-13 over the Milton Eagles. And right off the bat in the first quarter, it was Walton getting on top. Price Wilson, the quarterback, keeps it. He runs it in from 14 yards out to put Walton ahead 7-0. but then on the ensuing kickoff. And when I say ensuing kickoff, you know it's going to ensue. There he goes. Chad Toliver, number three, cuts back across the grain. He goes 99 yards for the touchdown on the kickoff return. This ties the game up at 7-7. Milton would then end a pair of field goals to take a 13-7 lead. Walton scores late in the first half. K.K. Brooks with the touchdown to make it 14-13, and that is your score at the break as we stand 14-13 right now. Now let's check in with the Milton Band brought to you by Regions Bank. The director of the Milton Band is Christopher Schumick. Tonight's theme is Rome, Echoes of an Empire. The song tonight is The Pines of Rome, Roman Festivals, and Music from Spartacus. Let's listen in. Milton Band brought to you by Regions Bank. Well played. Well, Atlanta Falcons coach Mike Smith has always said that the pipeline to talent into the NFL comes from high school football. I recently talked with some of the Falcon players, and one of them, linebacker Sean Weatherspoon, talks about his time under those high school Friday night lights.
Had a lot of great memories, you know. High school football, once I made varsity, you know, it was pretty much awesome. We won a lot of football games and had a great time. It seems like if we were winning, then school went a lot better as well, so it was all a good time.
Was there one game or one play that sticks out in your mind?
Yes, it does. My junior year, we went to the state semifinal game. We played at Kyle Field, which is where Texas A&M plays. And the last play of the game, I actually blitzed the B gap and made a play on the running back to win the game, so it was pretty awesome.
As a member of the Atlanta Falcons, what advice would you give to a Georgia high school football player?
I would just tell them to enjoy the moment, you know, go out there and have fun, play ball with your friends, because you'll never get those memories back. You know, it's kind of like kind of carefree. You're out there just playing ball, just like when you were a kid. So go out there, have a good time, and continue to get in the weight room so you can separate yourself from the other players.
Sean's healing up from an injury, and the Falcons are at Arizona on Sunday. Well, coming up on GPB's Football Fridays in Georgia halftime show, there's still a lot to come. We'll play another round of Are You Smarter Than Your Students with the Milton principal. John Nelson is going to preview next week's big rivalry game between Warner Robins and Northside Warner Robins. We'll have scores in our schedule. It's all ahead when Football Fridays in Georgia's halftime show continues right after this break on the great GPB.
The boy with the microphone, so wouldn't be standing here today.
The wheels of progress haven't been very active lately. But because of business people like you, things are beginning to get rolling. And Regions is here to help, making it easier with the expertise and service to keep those wheels turning. From business loans to cash management, we want to be your partner moving forward. Let's get going. Together.
Let's talk about the teams trying to get to the next level.
Here comes the- Each week, GPB brings you the latest in high school sports.
Hi again, everybody.
But we want to hear what you have to say. Tell us what's going on with your team. Share your favorite moments. Post your own pictures and videos. And let everyone know why your team will go all the way.
This team is the best you've ever seen. You haven't seen a game until you've been to one of them.
Just log on and like us on Facebook, where you can post comments, pictures, and videos to earn your own team bragging rights. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter, too.
Want to know why? Take a dip in the river of knowledge on this week's Why Wednesday. First, what does it take to set a river free? Chattahoochee Unplugged tells the story of how one man's dream to remove old dams and build an urban whitewater course became a reality, transforming both a river and a city into something new, unique, and remarkably special. Next, how can dropping the temperature down bring scientific breakthroughs up? On this episode of NOVA, host David Pogue explores the latest achievements in medicine, technology, and global good being propelled by making stuff colder. Finally, why do certain elements make the cut when building this massive, long-hauling Mack truck? Raw to Ready takes you inside the Mack factory to see how a particular mix of raw ingredients come together to create this modern, mass-produced workhorse. From the Chattahoochee's whitewater to the low end of the thermometer to building an advanced tractor trailer, it's a new Why Wednesday you don't want to miss.
Welcome back to a Halloween edition of Football Fridays in Georgia's halftime show. We are at halftime of the Walton-Milton game. It is Walton leading by one thin point, 14-13 over the host Eagles. Now it's time to head to the principal's office. Let's check in with John Nelson and Milton principal Cliff Jones. John?
Thank you, Mark. Yes, it is time for me once again to be in the principal's office, a place I spent a lot of time, and it's time to be in Mr. Jones's office. First name Mr., last name Jones. Obviously, Grace talked about it a little bit, but there's a lot of purple here on campus tonight. A great idea.
Well, we're proud to support the memory of Mike Scott, a teacher and coach and a friend, and our kids tonight support him by wearing purple. On November 9th, there's a pancreatic cancer walk that Milton has a team in his honor for. We're just so proud.
Very, very cool. It is that time to find out if he is smarter than his students. There's the helmet. Thank you, Jordan. All right, here we go with the question, and it is, which city is home to the official state vegetable of Georgia? Because we had the Agriculture Commissioner Gary Black on earlier, cooked us dinner. Is it A, Butts? Too many jokes. B, between, C, Flintstone, or D, Vidalia?
That is definitely D, Vidalia.
Man who knows his onions. Once again, you are smarter than your students, definitely smarter than me. Thanks for being a great host.
Thanks for coming tonight.
All right, send it back over to Mark.
All right, John, thank you very much. Time now to check out scores from around the state on our Georgia EMC scoreboard. Let's check things out right off the top. Collins Hill leading top-ranked North Gwinnett in 6A, 10-7 that game in the second quarter. It is Valdosta and Colquitt County in a big Region 1A game, 3-3 tied in the second. It is Camden County and Brunswick. Brunswick leading by a field goal in the second. Hillgrove trails Harrison by a touchdown, 21-14 in the second. Norcross leads Peachtree Ridge, 7-0 in the second. Tucker and Miller Groves just getting underway. It is Sandy Creek, top-ranked in 4A, taking on LaGrange, 7-0 in the first. Buford is leading Fannin County by a couple of touchdowns there. And that's the scoreboard that we have for you. For complete scores, just download the GPB Sports app. You can go to online to gpb.org/sports, and you can get all the videos, all the blogs, all you need. Just download our GPB Sports app and visit us on the web today. Time now to check out the rest of our schedule. There's only a handful of weeks left in the regular season before we hit the playoffs, but next week, a huge game in 5A. We are back at Hallford Stadium in Clarkson for undefeated and top-ranked Tucker taking on the Lions of MLK. Okay, we'll wrap up the regular season with Flowery Branch at Gainesville with Red Elephants outstanding quarterback Deshaun Watson. Then it's on to the playoffs, and we've got you covered all the way to the state championship games in mid-December at the Georgia Dome. Well, John Nelson is back. He's been a busy guy tonight, and he's got the story of one of the most intense rivalries, not only in the state of Georgia, but in the entire country.
And we talked about Swamp War in the open as one of the top 10 rivalries in the state. Next week in the International City, you will have 15,000 people in one place in a city cut in two. Here's your preview of Northside and Warner Robins. Proceed at your own peril.
Have you ever just flat not liked someone or something?
Biggest rivalry in Georgia, if you ask me. It's unbelievable. The fans, the student body, teachers, everybody's into it. It's just unbelievable feeling.
That pretty much sums up Northside and Warner Robins. And yes, we know that the town name is to the right of the hyphen where Northside is concerned. just don't ever use it.
That's huge. I mean, everybody, it's a ghost town outside of the stadium that night when we played Warner Robins. I mean, there are about 15,000 people there, and it's just a dream to play in it. And, you know, we obviously want to win. You know, I haven't lost to them in high school, so I want to keep that streak going.
I didn't really know about my dad until when my brother got here. And then everybody started telling me stuff, and I saw some stuff on film, and I just noticed that it was different for us.
Yes, it's just Northside, thanks, and Red and Blue do not like each other at all.
It's a great source of pride, and I enjoy the rivalry part of it. It's probably the longest week of my life and Coach Wade's life, and we're glad when that week's over with. But then again, it's a nice problem to have, and our community, it's just great for our kids to be able to be a part of something like that.
There's some families where one parent went to Northside and one parent went to Warner Robins. I don't know how they get along during that week. Matter of fact, I don't know how they get along anytime.
It's something else now. I think it's something special that, you know, I think everybody should be able to enjoy that. It's something that's hard to explain, but, you know, I love it. I wish we played like in front of crowds like that every Friday.
And for Jermaine, he's new to this whole thing, but it sunk in quick.
It felt like a college game, you know. I never came to a Warner Robins game, and that was my first game coming to when I felt the atmosphere, you know, it was great. Then I've been playing, I played in my last 3 years as a sophomore, so as an experience, it's a real good game to play in.
So next Friday night, if you hear a lot of noise to the south and maybe an earthquake, that's all it is, another round of Northside and Warner Robins.
So you see, Mark, it affects generations with Marcus, his older brother Marquez Ivory, and his dad. You're talking cop cars with plates that have the R that's red and the N that's blue. It's split in half. The mayor has a wife from the other high school, so that's what they're getting into every year.
Like the coach said, I don't know how they get along anytime.
Anytime.
All right, we'll see you back on the sidelines. Well done.
Time to get cold.
Let's check in with Grace Olson with another edition of Rent Check. Grace?
Out here on the chilly Milton sidelines with a very dedicated parent. This is Angel Sapp, the mother of linebacker Corte Sapp. We're here for a rent check. We're going to see how much you know about your son, okay? First of all, though, we want to show you a gem of a photo. How old was Corte in this photo?
He was about 12 months.
Okay, and you said he was a very sweet child?
Yes, definitely. Never gotten in trouble, doesn't break the rules, quiet, never, you know, just was an awesome kid.
Well, I'm sure that's definitely helped him on the football field in terms of dedication and focus. Now, let's get down to the trivia. Favorite book?
Oh, my goodness. That one I would not know. I'm just going to be honest with you. I don't know.
He said The Hobbit. We love to have some readers on this football field. Now, least favorite chore?
Milton High School.
Least favorite chore? Probably taking out the garbage.
He said cutting the grass, and I'm sure he gets a good workout out there too, especially in the summer. Now, if not football, what sport would he be playing?
Basketball.
Basketball, spot on. Good one with the third question. Dream job?
Probably an architect. I'm not sure.
Architect. Good one. You're 2 for 4. Okay, now favorite movie?
He has two. One is The Goonies and one is Hardball. So.
Okay, well, you got 3 out of 5. Good job, Mom, and those are quick answers. So thank you for joining us on Rent Check. Here's your Football Fridays in Georgia t-shirt. It's lovely. You can sport it under your coat, obviously, because it's very chilly out here. Thanks for joining us. Angel, go Eagles, she says. I'm going to send it back over to Mark on the set.
Thanks, Grace. Time now for our career play of the game, brought to you by the Technical College System of Georgia. Not every career keeps you cooped up in an office. Fields like agriculture, wildlife management, and forestry are perfect for anyone who loves working outdoors. Agribusiness is the oldest industry in the state. It's still economically vital, but today's agricultural careers require training and skills. Forestry is another outdoor career that's moving into the 21st century. New harvesting techniques require professional training. Careers are waiting for anyone ready to get out and get to work. That's why working in the great outdoors is our career play of the week. This message is brought to you by the Technical College System of Georgia. For more information, just go to tcsg.edu for more information on starting your new career. We're getting ready to kick off the second half of this game between Walton and Milton. But before we get back to the action, we want to tell you a way you can show your appreciation for high school football on GPB. You can text a $10 donation to keep programming like this on the air. All you have to do is text the letters GPB to the numbers 85944. Be sure to reply yes, and message and data rates may apply. This is our Halloween edition of Football Fridays in Georgia. We'll be back with more after this timeout.
as the demand for power grows.
Georgia's nonprofit, member-owned electric cooperatives
are committed to providing safe,
affordable,
and reliable electricity
to our members. We've been dedicated
to building strong
communities
for more than 70 years
and are proud to join
the Georgia High School Association
and Georgia Public Broadcasting
in support of our state's student athletes.
We are Georgia EMC, lighting the way.
Sometimes you get inspiration in the most unusual way. If you're a Georgia high school student, you can enter GPB's video contest, win $1,000, and make a difference. How can you help stop the drop?
GPB, winner of 15 Emmy Awards. Thank you for your support.
Welcome back, Eagles Nest, 14-3 as we get ready for the third quarter here downstairs with Coach D as we talk about what happened, and this is going to be a complex compound question. You talked to us about Toliver all week, and we saw what he's worth to you, but at the same time, the play late got you.
Yeah, it did. They ran a switch route. We knew it was coming. I mean, we're yelling switch on the sideline. We put us in the right coverage, but unfortunately, you're dealing with 16-year-old kids. He tried to jump the corner, and at the last minute, he realized the guy was going to the post, and he just got behind him.
So what else did you talk to him in the locker room other than stay warm and stay focused?
We got to sustain some drives and kept making stupid penalties. We've just been jumping offsides, lining up offsides. We got to stop that. And if we stop that and sustain a drive, I think we got a chance.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
Send it upstairs. Third quarter just around the corner. You guys have highlights and stuff, don't you?
We do. And here's the highlights to start off with. Here was the opening 50-yard pass to Chad Clay. And he did the majority of the work on that drive, but Price Wilson put the exclamation point on with a 14-yard run of his own, getting in the end zone with his legs. That was the first touchdown of the game. And then excitement ensued here as Chad Toliver took it to the house 99 yards and showed you a little bit of what makes him a very, very special player being recruited at the next level. And here's a big 56-yard run also, which set up Milton's first field goal of the night, which was a 22-yarder by Genovese. And here's a long pass in the second quarter from Wilson down the field to DJ Smith. And this set up Walton's second touchdown. This time it was K.K. Brooks following the block of Henry Rowling. And that's where we stand right now, 14-13. Keelan, take us through these stats.
I'm telling you right now, the time of possession jumps at my eyes right here. I look for Walton, 16 minutes, 22 seconds on the time of possession to Milton's 7 minutes and 38 seconds. Hey, I'm looking at the turnover margin, 2 zeros. That's good for both teams. But another thing, total offense, 246 yards to 125 yards. These teams definitely doing a really good job by running the ball. They're doing a great job of making sure they maintain their game plans on the offense side of the ball too as well. I have a bone to pick with Coach D. Now, you know, I was asking him some questions about Toliver. He was like, oh, he's just a player. He's just a guy who just jumped in after our number one running back. And I was like, well, what is he going to do good, Coach? He runs the ball well. You know, he's just a guy that we usually have on the defense side of the ball. Shoot me, Coach. Come on, man. This guy's a baller, man. I'm a fan. I'm his groupie now because I like the way he runs. He runs with his hands and keeps the ball up high. He uses his feet. And I'm telling you right now, nobody can bring this guy down on the first contact. That lets me know he has great finesse and he has great ability to be a good running back for the future for this ball club.
And their defense has played pretty well as well. As you heard Nelly talking to Coach about the big play that set up the late touchdown. And Walton's offense has done pretty well themselves. They have a huge first down advantage, 12-3. But after this touchback, Milton will try to do exactly what Coach D just talked to Nelly about, and that's sustain some drives. Just 3 first downs in the first half. And that 99-yard kickoff return by Toliver is really what's keeping Milton in this football game. But they do look awfully big and strong up front. You see McLeod's numbers, 2 for 3. The big pass was down the field to Zach Spezio. And there's Toliver's number, 7 carries for 72 yards. And we just talked about the 99-yard touchdown as he took it to the house on his first touch of the night.
I think they really just need to get back to establishing the running game to set up their passing game. That's how they started off this football game, by making sure they have long drives.
They've got Toliver in the slot, but they come back the other way. and it's knocked to the ground by Ridge Gibson as he gets his paw on it. Looked like the pass was intended for Spezio. It falls incomplete, second and 10.
That's a very nice play by the middle linebacker, Ridge Gibson, by getting his arms up, trying to throw the ball in there. Austin trying to throw the ball in that passing lane. This guy has 6 tackles for loss, 1 sack on the season, and 35 tackles on the season too as well. He's always around the ball, one of their leading tackles of this team, of this defense of Walton.
And McLeod hands off to Toliver in a nice hole. And he darn near breaks it into the next level. He's taken down by McKay Madsen. And he was a shoestring away from going to the house, but a late flag comes in.
A lot of my teammates always used to pick on the DBs, but usually the offensive guys used to pick on the defensive guys. Oh, that was a shoestring tackle. You didn't tackle me. You went for my feet. A tackle is a tackle. And anytime you tackle somebody to save a touchdown, you're the hero. You're the hero of the defense. Good job by the cornerback by coming up, by making the tackle by Ryan Logan. Because I'm telling you right now, that was to the house.
And a tremendous block by Jake English, the tight end on the outside, and a personal foul on Walton will tack on 15 yards. And you know that's driving Coach Rocky Hidalgo absolutely nuts. He told John on the sideline before he hit the locker room that they've got to eliminate the stupid penalties, and he pointed to a first half personal foul. And here he gets one on the opening possession. And there's Brisker. Nice tough run downhill for the world record holding weightlifter for a nice game.
Mr. 7 world record holder. I bet you he walks around campus like the man because he is. I bet you nobody will mess with this guy, man.
I wouldn't.
Oh, man. Talk about a football player.
Here's Toliver, another great block. But he goes down after a modest gain. They need to get to the 41.5 yard line for a first down, and they will be about a yard and a half shy of that here. Third down and short.
Nice tackle by the defense end, Drayon Williams. This young man has been a big time player for them all year. Second leading tackle on the team, 27.5 tackles on the year, 6 TFLs, tackles for loss.
Toliver trying to go second effort, and I'm not sure he got there. Stood up by DJ Smith and then pushed. And those are the kind of plays that Milton needs if they're to sustain those drives that Coach D was talking about. I'm not sure he got it.
Yeah, this is one of those situations where this defense is definitely like bowing down after a couple of penalties. Their backs against the wall starting off this drive. As you can see, they're doing a great job of shooting those gaps. As you see, number 42 fighting to create, to mess Mr. Toliver hold up there. He had the first down, but he definitely made sure he disrupted the line of scrimmage. Great job of Mr. Williams getting there.
Interesting formation here, as the preliminary signs are that the Eagles will go for it. They could draw Walton off sides and pick up a first down. We'll see if they try that.
Walton tried a fake field goal on fourth down. This is fourth down.
And there's Brisker. Oh, my word, as he stood up in the hole. By Imani Parker, mano a mano. Let's take a listen to that one if we've got it. Good grief.
Oh, my goodness. Man, just look at this hit. Just a football play, heads up. Oh, my goodness.
On a cold night, that makes my teeth hurt. Goodness gracious. Imani Parker, the player they call the ghost, because he just shows up and makes big hits, and he does right there. Number 33, he got the best of number 33 on that one.
It's a nice fourth down stop by Walton's defense.
And here's K.K. Brooks.
As we talked about all year, big-time players show up in big-time plays and make big-time games.
Brooks picks up 2 on the first down carry. So each team tonight has had a fourth down stop and forced a turnover on downs. It couldn't have come at a better time for the Walton Raiders. You see K.K. Brooks, 19 carries for 93 yards and that 10-yard touchdown in the second quarter. Wilson to Brooks. Brooks following Rowling. This time Rowling can't get any push on the linebacker, and it's no gain. Ryan Canso comes in to make the tackle. Also, Nick Anderson in on the stop.
Milton's done a great job tonight by disguising on the defense side of the ball, showing a cover two shell, not letting Walton know what coverage they're in. And at the snap of the ball, a couple seconds before the snap of the ball, they're showing a cover three to get that seventh man or eighth man in the box.
Third down and nine out of the pistol and flushed out. He dumps it off to K.K. Brooks. He's got some running room as he crosses into Eagle territory. Needed to get to the 46-yard line for a first down. They'll mark him right at the 46. And they'll award him the first down. Big heads-up play here by Wilson to Brooks.
Nice impromptu check down by KK. Number 44, Kristen Keeling, just making the tackle. Hey, I'm telling you right now, man. When you stay home on the defense side of the ball, you stay in your lanes, you never know when the quarterback or the running back is going to cut back across field. Those are touchdown saving tackles. Those are plays that gives your defense a second chance. Good job by the Sam linebacker.
K.K. Brooks, Rowling kicks out Corte Sapp, and K.K. Brooks has some running room. He breaks a couple tackles and gets inside the 25-yard line. It is taken down there by number nine, Zach Williams, 18 yards on the carry for K.K. Brooks, and that'll put him up over the 100-yard mark.
I want you guys to pay attention to the missed tackles on this play. There's one, there's two, there's three, there's four. Four missed tackles on one running play. Last week, what really hurt this ball club was missed tackles, and their defensive backs getting disposed. I know Coach D, when he pops that film on tomorrow morning, he's definitely is going to bring that to their attention. They're going to be running because of this one. That's the Cardinals. See them, bad angles, bad hat plate placement. You have to be able to wrap up, especially a big-time athlete like K.K. Brooks.
And Brooks is up over 100 yards, Keelan, but the player of the game is probably his fullback, Henry Rowling.
Yes.
The guy the coach said has been the most consistent player on the team. He's a basketball player. He's a UGA baseball commit. And he's the one forging those holes for number 10. And here's number 10 again, trying to use second effort, but can't, as he's swarmed under by four or five red hats for no gain. Chase Polkow, the strong safety, and Eric Peterson in on the play.
Yeah, this night's game tackling about his defense. You know, every time this defense gets down here in the close to the red zone, it seems like, you know, Walton can do whatever they want between the 40-yard lines. But when they get past that 30, man, it seems like this defense is somehow hunkered down every single time and see what they can do. With the ball on the 35-yard line.
Loss of two on the carry.
25, excuse me.
Third down and 12. Brooks stays in. Now they'll throw a screen to him. It's sniffed out, but he blocks the tackle and sniffing out the first down yardage, but he'll be a couple yards shy as he runs out of bounds at the 16-yard line.
It was almost a great defensive play by Marty Herring. As you can see him sniffing out the read. Look at him right there. He sees it. He just, you know, K.K. Brooks has turned on the boosters on him there and to get a little positive yardage. Good job by creating something with his feet.
But you were right, Keelan. They stiffened up once again deep in their own territory. And no field goal attempt this time for Walton. They're going to go for it on fourth down and two. Ridge Gibson checks in from the defensive side. He's now on offense, and he's in motion. Looks like they're trying to draw the Eagles off sides, and they do. And it looked like it may have been Corte Sapp who jumped. And there's Coach Pete DeWeese on the sideline, and his body language tells you everything you need to know here.
There's one of those hard count plays again. He speeds up like he was going to run out by the cornerback, Devon Williams.
It was Devin Wilkins that jumps off sides. And here is KK pursued on the backside by Charlie Fault, and he's taken down for no gain. Nice pursuit there by the middle linebacker, who's having a wonderful night tonight.
We're here in the PA announcers, same box that we're in, and then we've been hearing Mr. Fox's name on defense all night, somebody who's been around the football. And we talked about how Coach said he's a Friday night light player. He's the type of guy that you want on your ball club. He's an inspiration to those young guys because he's always around the football, and he leads them by example.
Second down and 10. Play action. Wilson goes end zone, incomplete, intended for Davis Pigeon, the tight end.
Nice pass break up by Eric Patterson, the strong safety coming in. The tight end had him beat. But you know, sometimes when you run hard to the football, good things happen, and the ball deflects off the free safety's forearm there. He was beat, but you know what? When you run hard to the ball, good things happen.
Difficult for a quarterback, Keelan, rolling to his left, a right-handed quarterback. And it'll bring up third down now. Pistol formation again. Again, Bryce Wilson rolling out to his left. Puts a little bit more mustard on it this time, and it's a touchdown for Davis Pigeon. 11-yard touchdown for the big tight end, and Walton extends their lead.
Talk about his big target for him, number 81. This young man has only been playing football for a year and a half. As you see him there with the neck roll, he does so many great things for this offense by setting the edge for the running backs in the running game, but also in the passing game. He looks good, has great size, and most importantly, as a tight end, you have to have good hands. And the hands definitely showed up on that play.
Lucas in to attempt the point after, and it is good. And check out the zip on this ball from Bryce Wilson to his big tight end. Number 81 puts six on the board. Walton leads 21-13.
The wheels of progress haven't been very active lately. But because of business people like you, things are beginning to get rolling. And Regions is here to help, making it easier with the expertise and service to keep those wheels turning. From business loans to cash management, we want to be your partner moving forward. Let's get going together.
Nothing prepares you better for a great career than the 25 colleges of the Technical College System of Georgia. TCSG colleges produce graduates with the knowledge and training today's top employers are looking for. With campuses across Georgia, state-of-the-art facilities, and outstanding instructors with real-world experience, it's the kind of affordable college education that will fast-track you into a rewarding career. We're building a better future for you. Contact the TCSG college in your area today or go to tcsg.edu.
21-13 Walton, and downstairs to Grace Olson.
Hey guys, this is more than just a night of football for the Milton Eagles. Tonight, they're honoring a beloved coach they lost last year to pancreatic cancer. Coach Michael Scott was with Milton for 6 years as a teacher and an offensive line and strength coach, and they've been doing fundraising efforts all year long since he passed away, and tonight they really wanted to honor him as best as they could. They're wearing these bracelets, purple sunglasses, purple bracelets, all that say things like honor Coach Scott. They also are wearing these t-shirts. They want to promote pancreatic cancer awareness, so the color purple is all over the place to promote that pancreatic cancer awareness. Also, I talked to a representative who said the cities of Milton and Alpharetta have named November the new Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, and this gives those guys on the field all the reason to play harder. Back to you guys up in the booth.
Thank you so much, Grace. Keelan sporting one of those purple ribbons, and Keelan, we talk each and every week about how much the coaches love their kids. Mm-hmm. This is a great example of how much the kids love their coach.
Yeah, Coach Scott, a.k.a. hashtag the big show. It meant so much for this to this program. He was a mentor, friend to his students, players, parents, and peers at Milton High School.
There's your scoring drive brought to you by TCSG. 11 plays, 56 yards, 3 minutes and 57 seconds. And Coach Hidalgo has to be pleased with the way that his offense is playing. Obviously not pleased with a couple of personal fouls. But they've extended their lead. And they've got the momentum in this football game as Christian Lucas kicks it away to Papura and Toliver. This time it'll be Toliver again. He's already taken one 99 yards to the house, following his blocks and trying to get to the sideline in good kick coverage as he goes down at the 25-yard line. And now we head downstairs to John Nelson.
All right, time to catch up on election coverage. Let's send you to Gwinnett County. The biggest news on the board at the top of the ladder right now, third quarter. Hayden Spire is out with an injury for North Gwinnett. They are trailing Collins Hill. Start of the third, 24-15. Norcross still leading Peachtree Ridge. Last time we heard it was 7-0. Also down a little further in the ladder, Duluth beating Hab Central 21-7 fourth quarter. But obviously, guys, we're going to keep an eye on what's going on up top. No Hayden Spire for North Gwinnett.
Thank you so much, John. You're always on top of things, and a painful loss for North Gwinnett. But it makes it a little bit more painful when your quarterback is the head coach's son. Hopefully that young man is okay.
Yeah, sources telling me about Hayden Spire. He said he will not be back in the second half there, John. He has an MRI on his left knee next week. So just keep our prayers and our thoughts go out to the Spire family.
Second down and 8 for the Eagle defense. Lone back in the backfield is Brisker. Pair of wide receivers to each side, and here is Brisker bullying his way ahead. Ball comes out, but he was down at the 30-yard line. It'll be a gain of 2 on the play and set up third down and 6.
So when you think that Brisker is just kind of like an overachiever with 7 world records, how do you parent a kid with 7 world records? How do you keep someone like that ego, and how do you keep him humble?
You say, take out the trash, and then you follow it with, please. And here he goes, Toliver. Oh my word, look at the speed, and darn near breaks another one. Young man's been electric tonight. He picks up a big Eagle first down inside Walton territory, 28 yards on the carry. And he should now be pretty close to 100 yards, if not over.
Let me tell you, it's something special. You just look at this young man runs the football. He just runs with authority. He runs with aggression. And what comes with authority and aggression is weightlifting. You know, as he goes over 100 yards right there, 11 carries with 114 yards. You know, I talked to Coach D this morning. He talked about Keelan. The only way we can compete in this level is lifting 5 days a week. It's one thing his ball club really does well. They lift. They get up and lift. That's what we do to compete in this region. This region is so tough. We have guys. We don't have all the best athletes on this team, but we have guys that really work hard in the weight room. And what working hard in the weight room comes with great dignity and great respect, and that's how we can compete in this level. That's one thing that we did. We did a lot in Florida. We talked about that. The schools that he had in Florida. I'm telling you, Dre, we was lifting on Sundays after games on Friday nights. So he brought that lifting program to Milton High School, and that's why these guys, you look at their bodies, their legs are strong, their calves are strong, their arms are strong, and that's why he's putting these guys in the next level in Division I. These guys are D1 ready when they go to school. Good job for Coach.
Brisker and Toliver having a good drive here, as is the offensive line. It's another first down. Tolliver's got 11 carries for 114 yards, 213 all-purpose yards if you count the 99-yard kickoff return. And Coach said that he's been a little bit limited. They would give the ball to Paulk 25 or 30 times a game, and right now they're having to limit Tolliver's carries to about 15, which is why you see Nico Brisker here, and it's also why you saw Toliver on the sideline down on the knee trying to catch his breath and get ready to check back into this game. The Eagles need him.
It's all right. He has a 7 world record guy and is a fullback who, he said, it's all right, Coach, give me the ball. I can hold on to a couple of rocks. And you look at his resume here, Toliver here, Florida State's looking at him, UGA, Mississippi State, Vandy, North Carolina. I'm like, Coach, tell me a little bit about this guy. He has all these schools looking at him. I guess he's this little secret weapon, I guess.
He is. Here goes Brisker running over somebody. 1 yard gain back to Toliver. Toliver, actually a phenomenal lacrosse player, actually has already been offered a scholarship by Rutgers to play lacrosse, a school that's renowned for their lacrosse, but says he wants to turn himself into a fantastic football player, and I'd say he's off to a good start.
He wants to be a gladiator, man, you know. Lacrosse is an interesting sport, man. You know, the great running back played lacrosse, Jim Brown.
That's a great point, Keelan. And there's Brisker again, picking up a big first down on third and short. And now Milton has four first downs in this half and only had three in the first half of football, thanks in large part to their running backs, Brisker and Toliver.
Now DJ Smith is no pushover now. He's a D1 school. He's a D1 player too as well. But going to ACC school or SEC schools offers out of everywhere, plays receiver and cornerback for him. But meeting Mr. Brisker in the hole, I don't think he wants any parts of him.
First and 10 from the 21, and Toliver back in the game. Get a little thunder and lightning as Toliver's down the sideline. And he's in the end zone for a touchdown. 21 yards for number 3. And the offensive line and the two running backs for Milton just put together their best drive of the game. And here's your Technical College System of Georgia replay. Don't blink, you'll miss it. There goes Toliver.
Yeah, talk about the weight room. You look at the strength of Toliver and Brisker just getting it done. No passes on this drive. 19 runs, 9 runs on this drive. No passes whatsoever. That's why Coach at Milton right now, get this offense back in here to take over the lead if he can with this 2-point conversion.
And they get it. Zach Spezio. And we got ourselves a tie ball game in Milton.
I'm telling you right now, the number one thing I have on my sheet right now here, Trey, that go-to guy, when they needed 2 points, they went to their main man, Zach Spezio, for the 2-point conversion.
So with a minute 43 to go in the third quarter, Milton answers back with a 9-play drive. A 21-yard touchdown run by Chad Toliver, who's put on a show so far tonight. And look at the intensity over on the sideline. There's your TCSG scoring drive summary. 9 plays, 74 yards, 4 minutes and 8 seconds. Toliver now 12 rushes for 144 yards, lest we forget the 99-yard kickoff return in the first quarter as well.
Coach D really expressed how running the football is a major part of his offense. And I'm going to be honest with you, by talking with him, I think he was really, like, concerned about his running game going into this football game. Trey, he wasn't sure if Toliver was ready to really, like, take on those 30 carries a game. And he definitely just put the ball in his hands tonight. And Oliver's definitely just making sure that he put his team on his back. 12 carries for 144 yards with two TDs, actually, one on special teams.
That's right.
And one on offense.
There's Genovese's kick. High tight spiral taken by Smith at the 2. And Smith gets stood up and then is taken down at the 20-yard line. Let's take a look at Toliver's night. It's been an electric one. He started it off this way with a 99-yard kickoff return on his first touch of the game to knock this game up at 7 apiece. And he's been doing things like this the rest of the night. There's a 56-yard run to set up a field goal. There's another long run, breaking tackles one after the other. And here he is moments ago on the 21-yard touchdown run. And the 2-point conversion by Zach Spezio has turned this into a 21-21 ball game.
He runs with great instinct. A running back who keeps everything together. You know who he really reminds me of in his running style is No'Shawn Marino. You look at some of the highlights from No'Shawn Marino when he was in college and even in the NFL right now. His hands placement, his vision, the lanes that he cuts back on. He definitely has potential of the next level. If he can keep his head and go to college, make his grades, make friends, and make scouts love you.
That's right, and that's a very apt comparison, Keelan. And they just tried to run a reverse to DJ Smith, and it was sniffed out very well by middle linebacker Grant Piegler. No gain on the play as Walton tries a little bit of trickery. Second down and 10 now. Down inside, a minute to play here in the third quarter. That's Clay in motion. And they throw it to him in the flat. And they hem him in very well. Junior cornerback Lucas Nedza.
A little frustration right there by Clay. You don't want to get yourself caught in another 15-yard penalty, unsportsmanlike. I know it's frustrated out there. You're definitely in a dogfight tonight. But this is a very, very nice defensive play by Milton.
Third down and long after the loss. Third and 13. Wilson stepping up in the pocket and now sacked. And how he held on to the ball, I have no idea. But it was Michael Collins, the defensive end, the 6 foot, 200 pound junior who's been hurt lately with some stinger problems, has played sparingly, but he makes the most of it here. His first sack of the night and the first sack on Price Wilson as well.
Trey, you play defensive end, you play the deep line position, you know how hard it is to keep that motor going. And they say stick with it, keep those arms moving, get that offensive tackle hands off you. Michael Collins did a great job. He fell down to the ground, but he stayed relentless and was able to get the sack.
A beautiful punt by Spittler, taken at the 49-yard line by Papura. Just our third punt of the night, and a very late flag comes in at the 15-yard line, and now another one comes in. Looks like Henry Rowling is jawing back and forth with the official. Let's wait on the call. A 34-yard punt by Spittler.
Cool. As you look at this last sack right here, Michael Collins coming off the edge. As you see right there, he beat his man. I talked about they have to win the one-on-one matchup battles in the football game in order to compete and win this football game. As you can see, Milton fighting for every inch on the defense side of the ball. Good job by their defense end.
And you see Coach Hidalgo on the sideline getting the explanation from the officials. It's a personal foul on each team.
Fine.
9 seconds to go in the third quarter, knotted up at 21 apiece here in Milton. Toliver checks back in at tailback, a young man who had 72 yards on the last drive and 72 yards in the first half. And he has been the go-to guy so far tonight, and Milton will have a short field and momentum. Here is Toliver up inside, 4 yards before he's even touched as he goes down at the 45-yard line.
You know.
And that'll do it for the third quarter. An exciting 12 minutes of football coming up as we'll decide a huge region battle here in 5-6A. One of these teams' playoff hopes will be improved. The other will have an uphill battle for the next 2 weeks. Don't go anywhere. Fourth quarter coming up.
The digital age has made it possible for people to live wherever they want and still be connected. So at Emory, we're looking at ways to take big city healthcare beyond the big city. We now have more than 1,800 physicians and over 200 care facilities, creating a widespread network. And we're training nurse practitioners and physician's assistants in critical care, putting their talents to use in new ways. It's all making advanced care faster, more affordable, and bringing it to people in their own backyard.
Good evening, I'm Patrick Crosby. Third quarter numbers are now out from Georgia-based UPS, and shareholders may be happy with the delivery of the news. UPS reporting $1.1 billion in earnings. At the same time last year, that number was $469 million. The package delivery giant also reporting revenue was $14 billion. That is up 3.5%. Atlanta Business Chronicle now reporting that Delta is seeking to re-up its contract with its home base, Atlanta's Hartsfield-Jackson International Airport. The Chronicle reporting both sides looking at a possible 30-year long-term lease, part of a new master plan expected on paper in 2014. The EPA has now confirmed what had been previously reported, that Georgia Power's plant share releases the most greenhouse pollutant gases of any single facility in the United States. The EPA estimate is 22 million metric tons. Georgia Power saying that is proportionate with the giant size of that coal plant, and those pollutants are actually down 1% from last year. The infamous Piggly Wiggly brand with its smiling pig logo is about to fade away. Bylow Holdings, as part of its purchase, is rebranding the stores to call them Bylow. This will be seen at hundreds of stores. The company saying, for example, in Savannah, those stores will close on November 2nd, reopen November 8th with the new branding, No Pig. That's your business update, powered by Atlanta Business Chronicle. I'm Patrick Crosby. Have a good night.
Let's talk about the teams trying to get to the next level.
Twenty-one, start of the fourth quarter here in Milton. It's been a fantastic game. Thank you for joining us. There's a shot of Coach Pete DeWeese, the defensive coordinator, who was rallying the troops during the break, Keelan.
Yeah, he definitely was rallying his troops, just letting his troops know, hey, good job. Keep it up. We're in a dogfight. Guys, look, they're going to run the football. They're going to keep it at us. We have to make sure we stay strong in our front seven or eight. Just get that safety in the box. He's coaching them up. He's one of those passionate guys. He's running out on the field, chest bumping his players at the big time plays, at the fourth down stops, a couple of them tonight. For this Milton defense, he does a really good job by keeping these guys really engaged into the game.
Second down and six, Toliver trying to bounce it outside. It is almost wrapped up for a five-yard loss by DJ Smith. Now reverses field down the far sideline and knocked out of bounds by Ben Hood, a touchdown-saving tackle, but a 30-yard run by Chad Toliver.
Just a very nice run. DJ Smith coming out of the safety position out of nowhere, that closing speed, they just couldn't wrap him up. He cuts back across the field. Toliver said, hey, I got to make something happen for this misplay. Just keeping the play alive, that's what you really want to see in your young running back. This guy's closing in 200 yards tonight, 15 carries for 179 yards and a pair of touchdowns.
And here's Brisker as they try the middle, and they attempt to soften the defensive front here for Walton. Remember, their last touchdown drive was 9 consecutive runs. Both teams tonight, Keelan, looks like they have tried to go blue collar and run the football. Walton tried one pass, which was incomplete on the first drive of this half. Since then, on the Walton side, it was 14 straight runs, and now we're getting a heavy dose of Brisker and Toliver for the second straight possession.
One thing Coach D knows about, and I like to call it, is smash mouth football. It's smash mouth football, it's north-south football, and we're going to run the football. We're going to challenge our team on defense to stop them, and that's what both teams are doing on both sides of the ball. Hey, if it's not broke, why fix it? Getting north-south right now, that's what you want to see in a big-time game.
And the big junior Miko Brisker, nice carry on second down, which will set up a very manageable third down and one.
And as you see the score, 21-21. Whatever team's in the best condition and shape tonight.
Toliver, touchdown! 6 yards for Toliver, the third time he's found the end zone tonight. And Milton has recaptured the lead. And you see Hidalgo trying to encourage his defense. It's been the Chad Toliver show. Here's your TCSG touchdown replay, Keelan.
This is straight right up the middle as he follows his big-time fullback, missed the 7 world record. He's clearing the lane open. He bounced it outside, and it's open for him for a touchdown. And I'm telling you, both of these teams are going tit for tat right now. And it's going to come down to who is the strongest. Who's going to survive? Who's the best conditioned football team on this football field tonight? They have themselves a dogfight, and that's why they lift a lot of weights. We'll be right back.
Georgia Peanut Commission, offering Power Pack Georgia Peanuts as a delicious snack and fuel for the big game. Georgia peanuts are the official state crop of Georgia, with almost half of all peanuts in the U.S. produced by Georgia farmers.
The German Consulate in Atlanta, encouraging you to study German and to learn more about our diverse culture with much to discover in 2013. More information about Germany as an environmental leader and other current topics on the web at germany.info/Atlanta.
You have to seize any advantage you can get to build a career even while you're still in high school. That's why the Technical College System of Georgia offers dual enrollment. You earn college and high school credit at the same time, saving you money on college tuition. It's about your future. Dual enrollment jumpstarts your college education and prepares you for work in exciting career fields. Talk to your parents, school counselor, or a TCSG college about dual enrollment, or go to tcsg.edu.
.28-21, Milton has regained the lead and momentum. Downstairs to John Nelson.
All right, you see Chad Toliver trying to catch his breath. Let's try to catch ours here. You see how things were wrapping up at the beginning of the evening. Walton Milton in the middle of the package. Right now, Lassiter is beating Wheeler 33-21. So if this holds, Lassiter goes to 4-1. Etowah was winning also. They would go to 4-1. And then you've got Milton now would go to 3-2 a game behind. Walton would drop to 3-2. So you're looking at Roswell, Cherokee, and once again, guys, we've always thought that this was going to be five or six teams looking for the four spots. A little juggling going on, but not a whole lot. It's just that the names are the same. The places might be a little different if this holds.
Absolutely, and we heard from Coach D on the phone yesterday, and he said, my boys understand the importance, and they're well aware of the fact that they need to win two of the last three games to make the postseason. Now, Walton could pretty much assure themselves of a playoff appearance of some sort with a win tonight, but they're going to have to come back to do it now. And let's head downstairs on the sideline to Grace Nelson, who has the answer to tonight's trivia question.
Who doesn't love some trivia, especially when it comes to football? I asked you guys in the second quarter, when was the last time Milton beat Walton? The answer, 1994. Kyle Tilley was the first to answer the trivia question on Twitter. And Milton is leading 28-21, so they're trying to change history tonight. Make that 2013 instead of 1994. Back to you guys up in the booth, and congratulations, Kyle Tilley.
All right, thank you so much, Grace. And there you see Price Wilson, who will have to lead the troops back if Walton is to win this game and improve their region record to 4-1. They're sitting at 3-1 now. And here's a draw play. First time we've seen that tonight for KK Brooks.
Nice tackle by Christian Keenley coming in there. And Trey, you talk about both these teams being really aggressive on the running the ball, smash mouth football. Hey, we're not going to pass the ball, hey, because nobody can really stop our running game. But defense, somebody's defense really has to make a stop here. The game's too close to allow these two teams to keep running the ball down the field. This defense has to make a stop. Somebody has to get the turnover, because I think that's going to be the difference in this ball game. Whoever can stop their offense or get a turnover, that's going to be the game changer.
And there's a sack, and it could be a sack fumble. Wilson went down. Did the ball go down? It was junior defensive tackle number 96, Nick Steinhaus. And it looks like Jack Henry, the offensive tackle, actually recovered that. And a huge hit, Steinhaus on Wilson. Second time he's been sacked, and the ball did go out. And a heads-up play by Jack Henry. Third down now. And here comes Steinhaus again, but Wilson gets rid of it this time and down to one knee to catch it. Is Chad Clay. It will not be good enough for a first down. It'll be fourth and five, and Walton will have to punt as Hutt and Spittler takes the field. And Hidalgo urging his young men to stay engaged in this football game.
With a nice return here by Milton, can give their team a really good field position. With 8 minutes left to go in the fourth quarter,
to start the drive.
There's the rugby kick by Spittler. Papura has to retreat. He takes the fair catch at the 17-yard line. 42-yard punt, and downstairs to John Nelson for a quick update.
Time to go to Region 7. We were all concerned about Hayden Spire's injury. North Gwinnett once again showing they can score in bunches, now up 25-24 over Collins Hill. Down 9, now up 1. So much for that 9-point deficit, huh?
And that's with their backup quarterback, too, Nelly.
Now, sometimes they always find a way to crawl back and grind it out, man. You know, winning those close games and those close battles, you have to be able to win.
You look back at any championship team, and they always have those close calls, and they're always able to band together. And so far, that's what they've done this year over in North Gwinnett in Suwanee. And here is Toliver.
What has Walton has done, Walton has took their best defensive player, the strong safety, DJ Smith, and brought him into the box at the cornerback position on the short side of the field. So there you go. You have another hat coming into the box to stop Mr. Chad Toliver. As you can see, DJ Smith coming up to make that tackle from his cornerback position. Nice game planning by the Walton's defensive coordinator.
It was a one-yard gain for Toliver, and after his last touchdown run, we noticed that he looked pretty gassed on the sideline. He's done a great job tonight coming into this drive. He had 185 yards rushing, 284 all-purpose yards. So he has every right to be a little gassed. And they've given it to him here on three consecutive plays. This time he's dropped for a loss by Ridge Gibson. Also number 42 in on the tackle.
This nice penetration. That's one thing you definitely have to have on the defense side of the ball. The defensive lineman getting to the second level. Hey, you know, Walton did a great Milton did a great job by stopping Walton. Now it's Milton's turn to really get this drive going on another level. You have to be able to move these chains. There's a lot of time left in the ball game. Hey, your main man Toliver is tired with 18 carries, 184 yards, two touchdowns tonight, and also a 99 kickoff to the house. So you definitely have to find somebody else in there to give him a breather, because he is not used to carrying ball that many times.
And there's Brisker again on third down and 11, and they opt to go very conservative there, Keelan. They're going to put the impetus on their defense, which has played very well tonight.
And you see Mr. DJ Smith walking back towards in the punt formation. They have two returners. They have Clay back there, their receiver, and also DJ Smith. So they really need a special teams play. They really need something to spark them.
And there's Moskowitz, who's been one of the best punters in the state this year. And he hangs it up high for Smith, and Smith drops it, then recovers it, now has to retreat, and is dropped for a huge loss.
Very nice special teams play by Milton's special teams, the punt team.
And Matt Moskowitz, the punter, is down at midfield. He ran down on coverage and looked like he hurt himself. Be sure to catch GPB's Emmy Award-winning Nature Series, Georgia Outdoors, this fall on GPB. See the beauty of the state in all four seasons of its glory and find out about its remarkable natural habitats. Georgia Outdoors, this Sunday at 7:30, only on GPB. Hey, fellas. Looks like they're tending to Moskowitz's left leg. And Coach D was very impressed with this young man. He had a game earlier in the season that he averaged 59 yards a kick, and he's a very highly rated punter.
Yeah, sources just telling me he's the number two punter in the country, just committed to Vanderbilt, too, by the way. So a lot of people don't know that yet. Just my sources tapped me on the shoulder and told me, number two punter in the nation going to Vanderbilt. Vanderbilt, who knocked off Georgia last week. So they have a lot of sick dog fans out there, including myself. Tough week for us.
I'm with you, partner. And it looks like they're tending to the left leg. We're going to take a break while they tend to Moskowitz at midfield. With 6:08 to go in this football game, it's 28-21 Milton.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is made possible in part by Regions Bank, it's time to expect more. Georgia's Electric Membership Corporation, lighting the way. Technical College System of Georgia, learn more, earn more. And by viewers like you, thank you.
As the demand for power grows,
Georgia's nonprofit,
member-owned electric cooperatives
are committed to providing safe,
affordable,
and reliable electricity
to our members.
We've been dedicated
to building strong
communities
for more than 70 years
and are proud to join
the Georgia High School Association
and Georgia Public Broadcasting
in support of our state's student athletes.
We are Georgia EMC, lighting the way.
The wheels of progress haven't been very active lately. But because of business people like you, things are beginning to get rolling. And Regions is here to help, making it easier with the expertise and service to keep those wheels turning. From business loans to cash management, we want to be your partner moving forward. Let's get going together.
Back in Milton, 28-21, the Eagles lead the Raiders. And you see a shot there of the punter, Moskowitz, who has a smile on his face but looked like he might have hurt his left knee, running down on punt coverage. And you'll see a nice shot. If you look at the very top left of your screen, you'll see a pair of legs come in, and he plants his left leg in the ground, and you can see his knee buckle just a little bit. If you're looking at the top of your screen there, you see that foot going to the turf right there.
Yeah, this very unfortunate. A great player, fifth strongest player on this football team. As we talked about, Coach D is making sure everybody in this team, making sure they hit the weight room, and the kicker, the fifth strongest player, offers Vanderbilt and Navy. He actually wanted to go to Harvard, but once he saw a lot of D1 schools coming in and taking a look at him, he quickly changed his mind about playing football at the next level.
Play action. And it looks like Charlie Fault, the middle linebacker. It's actually Jordan Parisian, the free safety, picks off the Price Wilson pass. And just like we said, they opted to go conservative on the last offensive drive because they trusted their defense. They made the right call. First turnover of the game as Parisian intercepts Price Wilson.
Hey, you know, I always talk about selling yourself out for big time plays. Good job by Jordan Parisian on that, by selling out and making the catch. Oh man, big time players step up in big time games, and he definitely did that. If you want to get your name called on TV, baby, around the state of Georgia, that's the way to do it.
And now for the second time in this half, it's a short field to start for the Eagles. And here goes Mr. Toliver again down near the 40-yard line. It's a nice chunk of yardage on first down. And with that interception, Jordan Parisian has three on the season. He led the team coming in with two, and he extends that lead with his third of the season. Manages to find a way to be in the right spot at the right time in probably the biggest moment of the season for Milton. We talked about in the pregame, Keelan, that Milton may not have had their signature win of the season yet.
Right.
Tonight could be that signature win. Perhaps they're 5 minutes and 20 seconds away from it.
Well, the main reason why they got their signature win, we definitely have to shout out this Milton offensive line. These guys are playing very well by creating the lane for Chad Oliver and also their quarterback, Mr. Seven World Record. These guys up front, Ernest, Nick Wilson, Tyler Perry, Max Maroon, and also on the right tackle, Jake. These guys are doing really good for him. You know, you got a big-time player in 51, Nick Wilson, up on the front of the line. He's the second-best guard in the country as a junior. And also left tackle, Ernest Dye, somebody who plays very well. He uses hands and his feet. And That's what you got to have at a caliber type offensive line. These guys are 5-2 as a record. They're 2-2 in the region, and a must win tonight. They're a big part of why these guys are up right now.
McLeod gives it to Toliver. Toliver collides with Brisker and tries to get to the outside, and he's taken down by DJ Smith. The flag goes down as well in the backfield.
That's just one of those things where Toliver, you know, he has a lot of speed, you know, and one thing about becoming a better running back, and he will learn this with film study, he will learn this with better coaching. You have to be able to let a play develop, especially an offensive running play. You know, as you can see him bumping his running back in the backfield there, if he's just a little bit patient and waits on that offensive lineman to pull, he can cut back off that offensive lineman block and get positive yardage instead of getting negative yardage.
Well, after Toliver picked up 6 or 7 yards on first down, a nice tackle by Ridge Gibson, and now the next play was a penalty. This is playing right into the hands of the Raiders as they need to possess the ball one more time if they want a chance to put some more points on the board. And of course, Coach D and the Milton Eagles want to control this clock by running it down and picking up their sixth win of the season and ensuring themselves of back-to-back winning seasons for the first time since 2008. And we've got another penalty down. This one may be a false start on the Eagles.
You talk about shooting yourself in the foot. This is what you don't want to see. It's 4 minutes left in the ball game. You're up 28-21, like you were just talking about, Trey. Running a football is the main factor, but now you got yourself in a third and long. Do you give yourself an opportunity? Do you go to your number one playmaker, Zach Sparino, who's your go-to guy? Or do you run the ball and just punt the ball on the next down? Timeouts remaining, Walton 3, Milton 3. So both of these teams are doing a really good job of controlling the clock and making sure that both of their offenses are in the right position, because no timeouts has been taken in this half.
Third down and 22 for the Eagles after back-to-back penalties. And they give it to Brisker. And Brisker is stood up in the hole by Imani Parker. Second time tonight we've seen those two collide.
This is a very nice defensive play. These guys staying at home. As you see the outside linebacker coming up, making the tackle. Imani Parker just chopping his feet, staying in the football position and wrapping up. This young man hits very well, and he's been out there on the football field coming up with some big plays tonight.
So a punting situation. And it's Lane Allison in to punt in lieu of Matt Moskowitz, and it's a good one, 32 yards, and we head downstairs to John Nelson. Nelly?
All right, time for some odds and ends here in election coverage. Buford over Fannin County, 45-8. Other winners tonight, Marion County, we focused on them in Johns, Georgia in the open. Mary Persons, Camden over Brunswick, 18-12. Pepperell a winner, Houston County a winner, Elbert County beat Hart County. Clinch County won Swamp War by a final of 34-7. Also on the board that we were looking at right now, Peachtree Ridge is leading Norcross 27-17. So that could take Region 7 and have some fun with it. Archer gets their first ever region title in school history, beating South Gwinnett tonight 48-31. So guys, you're talking about 7 and 8. A bunch of crazy action going on in Region 7 and 8 and 6A. Next week, we're going to be in Region 5, 6, Region 6, 5A, if I can get all my A's together, for the matchup that we're going to have at Hallford Stadium. Some action in there. Tucker was winning 34-6 and MLK up 6-3 in the second quarter.
It's going to be a fantastic matchup next week in DeKalb County. It'll be a chilly one over there in Hallford Stadium. It always is. And back-to-back incompletions. First one for Bailey Wolf, second one for DJ Smith. And with 2:43 to go, the biggest third down of the game upcoming for the Walton Raiders. They desperately need to put a drive together. They may not get another chance.
One thing I really like that Coach Rocky said over the phone, he said one thing about his ball club, and you know, he was kind of disappointed because they just couldn't have the season that they really wanted to have, that they used to. He talked about, we really have to make sure we pay attention to tempo. Our coaches are coaching hard, paying attention to detail. We have to run the football. We have to definitely work on our feet work. And I really like that because when things are going wrong, some coaches can just turn away and not really pay attention to the details. They can just stop coaching as hard. And that's when your players, they can really see that, and they give up themselves.
Well, Coach Hidalgo is no doubt a leader, and he's an emotional leader. You never have to guess what he's thinking. It's written all over his body. And that one goes right through the hands of Chad Clay. The sophomore couldn't pull it down. It would have been a first down. Instead, they bring on the punting team.
It would have been a first down and some there, Trey. Just a nice crossing route across the middle. As you see, Price stands in the pocket and right through his one of his number one receivers, Chad Clay, who's averaging 14.8 yards per catch. As you can see right there, you have to make sure you keep your eye on that ball and see it all the way through.
And Spittler to punt. He's been busy doing this the entire second half. Papura gets away from it, and it takes a huge Walton bounce. It's a 46-yard punt, no return. And with 2:24 to go in the game and a 7-point lead, you can expect a heavy dose of the run game for the Milton Eagles as they'll try to salt away the remaining 2:24. But Walton does have their full complement of timeouts.
Oh, yes.
Expect them to take them.
This is a coaching moment right here, guys, for both sides of the ball. If I'm Coach D, I'm telling my team, you have to hold on to the football. Hey, guys, we can put this one away if we can get us a couple first downs. You know, and to force these guys to use their timeouts, and that's what you have to do. And if I'm Coach Rocky, I'm on the sideline saying, hey, telling my defense, I'm yelling, hey, we need turnovers, strip the ball, hit these guys low. We need the game tackle. We need the ball back to our offense.
Miko Brisker on the carry for 3 yards. Tackle made by Kyle Whitaker. Let's take a look at the schedule. Here's Milton's schedule. We talked about the fact that they have not yet gotten their signature win. They have lost 2 in a row coming into this game to the top 2 teams in the region as it now stands. Tonight would be their signature win. They have winnable games against Cherokee and Woodstock to end the season. And as Coach D said, 2 wins in the next 3 games will get us into the playoffs.
And I'm going to tell you right now, man, the one reason why that this team is hanging in here tonight is because of that one guy there, their defensive coordinator. He's been doing a great job. And you talk about enthusiastic. Look at this belly bump. Check this out right after the pick. Hey, there he is. That's what I'm talking about. All 300 pounds of it, baby. He's intensified, man. Hey, those players feed off that, Trey. Did you have a defensive coach come up to you and just belly bump you out of nowhere, man?
I can't say that I have, but if that doesn't get you excited and give you a glimpse into what is so special about high school football in Georgia, I don't know what will. And here's Toliver trying to find the outside and wisely goes down. Doesn't want to go out of bounds here. Will likely force Walton to take their second timeout, and they will. And during this timeout, we'll take a look at Walton's upcoming schedule. Now, Keelan Walton, if they were to come back and win this football game, could have a de facto region championship of sorts against Etowah next week. Of course, they would need Lasser to lose another game in order for them to win the region. But right now, it's going to be an uphill battle. Etowah right now sitting as the number one team, Roswell sitting as the number 5 team in the region. If they don't win this football game tonight, it's going to be an uphill battle to get into the playoffs. As we mentioned before, Walton's been there 11 out of the last 12 years.
Well, I'm going to tell you right now, so much football left to be played in this football game. The one thing that this coach, we know he has, is fight in him. And both of these teams are fighting. And he's had his team hold it up right now. He's letting them know, hey, guys, we have timeouts. Okay, we got one left. All right? We just need you guys to do your job. It's a big down right here, 3rd down coming up. We need the ball back. So I'm telling you right now, we need to be stripping the football. That's the number one job that I should be yelling in my head if I was the coach.
3rd down and 7. They go conservative. It's Brisker. He's met in the hole by a host of Walton Raiders. And Ridge Gibson coming in to make the tackle. Last timeout taken by Walton as we head downstairs to Nelly.
You wanted to know what else was going on here in the region. Etowah right now leading Woodstock 35-28. So as we looked at the region standings, as things had followed through, we kind of anticipated that Etowah would win. And we're seeing that it could be that region championship showdown next week that you're talking about. So it looks like as everything is progressing through, there's Etowah right now, could move to 4-1 by the end of the night, 7-1 overall. Walton, if they come back, would make it to 4-1, but Milton looks like right now, if things hold for the next 127 seconds, that they'll go to 3-2. So once again, 6-4, guys. Square peg, round hole. What do you think?
That's right, and we told you in our extra point segment that if there is a tiebreaker needed to decipher the fourth playoff team, that they would not settle that on the field. They would actually flip a coin.
Yeah.
Although Coach D. Cristofaro wanted to implement what he used to use down in Florida, and they'd actually go out on the field on a Saturday or Sunday, and they'd play mini games to figure out who would win. Not so much in this region. It'll be a coin.
Trey, I can relate to that. I remember my sophomore year at Atlantic High School before I transferred to Mainland. We was in a four-way tie, and we had to travel to Titusville, basically an hour and a half outside of Daytona Beach, and to play a football game for two football quarters, man. And that was an interesting experience for me because that was new. You know, that was the first time in a while that they had a team in a four-way tie. And they took the best two teams who ever played, and those teams advanced.
Check us out next Friday with Football Friday's All-Access Pass show live at 7 o'clock, followed by the Game of the Week. We're live at Hallford Stadium, where Tucker High School welcomes the MLK Lions for a spectacular November game. It's GPB Sports Football Friday's All-Access Pass show, followed by MLK and Tucker. It's the Game of the Week, November 1st at 7 o'clock, right here on GPB.
And I know John is going to probably get involved in the bands down there, man. That's going to be another one of those games that we can see Nelly directing the band, because both of those teams have good marching band.
I would stipulate to that they have both very good bands. The Kings of Halftime will be something really worth checking out next week. The KOH, as I'm 2-for-2. I think probably for the good of the viewer, I probably should do maybe only one a year, because you don't want to be subjected to my rhythm but once.
Let me tell you, it's not just for the good of the viewer. That's all I'll say.
For the good of the McDaniel, for the good of the Keelan.
Yes, it is.
For the good of the planet.
There's Allison punting, and he shanks it off the side of his foot out of bounds around midfield. And now let's talk about the implications of the short punt. Walton down by 7. Matt Moskowitz was injured 2 punts ago, and Allison's punt a few moments ago was a great one. That one was not. And Walton gets the ball back with tremendous field position, down by 7. They have not had a short field many times tonight. And we're in for some high drama here with a minute 50 to go.
Well,
there's Moskowitz on the sideline nursing that sore left leg.
To be honest with you, they've done a great job by driving the ball down the field. It doesn't matter where the ball was on the football field tonight, whether it was a 75 drive or whether it was a 25-yard drive. They do a great job of a point of attack with K.K. Books in the backfield by getting to the edges and running north-south after the blocks made in the second levels. This team can be dangerous with a short field.
Keelan, we were here last week.
Yeah.
Same position.
Welcome
it was North
back.
Cobb against McEachern. North Cobb pulled out a 2-point victory. And it's gone down to the wire so far tonight. Trey McDaniel, Keelan Johnson, John Nelson with you on Football Fridays. We thank you for watching.
As you can see, Toliver at cornerback down here at the bottom of your screen. Hey, coach said, hey, this is a desperate measure here. I need my best players on the football field at all times. And, hey, you got to go to him. And don't forget, he was a defensive back before going to running back, Trey.
Great call, Keelan. He's matched up on Bailey Wolf, sprinting out and trying to look for Chad Clay, and a flag comes in very late, all the way on the opposite side from the play. Flag was in the area of where Bailey Wolf and Chad Toliver were locking horns. Illegal man downfield for Walton, and that one hurts.
Milton's defense, they're back there playing that cover two, man underneath. So one thing about man underneath, you're going to give up those out routes. You're going to give up those stops. You're going to give up those curl routes. It should be a bang-bang play, but you're going to allow those guys to accept that football there. But they have to be tight coverage underneath here as they line up in this cover two shell defense.
First and 15 from the 45. Wilson just turns and throws, and the route is jumped. And darn near picked off by Nedza, and that would have sealed it.
Talk about a corner play. I love to see defensive backs react to late passes. And this was a late, pass. Price just standing in the pocket. Did you see him sell out, baby? Every little inch matters as he extends his body. Great job by Lucas, the cornerback.
Second and 15 now. And remember, no timeouts. If they throw the ball into the middle of the field, they'll have to run up to the line of scrimmage and get a playoff. A first down will stop the clock momentarily. Throwing it outside, DJ Smith, and he gets out of bounds at the 45-yard line. He will be short of the first down, but he does stop the clock.
See another, as you see, another out route there, that cover two shell by Milton's defense. They're just sitting back, giving this offense some room to go down the field here.
Run the same play, this time to no avail. Incomplete, intended for Smith. Toliver was there on the coverage.
The last thing I'll be doing is throwing it to Tolliver's side, to be honest with you. And this is fourth down and six, a big down coming up. Well, this defense stepped up numerous of times tonight on fourth down to stop this offense.
This is the game right here if Walton can't make it. Fourth down and six from the 46. Here's Wilson throwing, and he throws it short as he's hit in the backfield. And he remains on the ground for a second as he realizes that that'll be his last attempt of the night. And it's Michael Collins, the defensive end, with his almost second sack of the night, but that one will do. He knocks Wilson to the ground. Pass falls incomplete. Milton takes over.
Collins is having a really good game. I talk about those one-on-one matchups. Look, you see him jump the inside, getting the pressure on the quarterback by making it a short throw. Those are the type of plays that you have to make in big-time games. That is a highlight reel, giving him the nice juke to the outside, coming in for the nice jab in between, as you see Milton right here taking the knee.
A coach's favorite formation, Keelan, victory formation.
That's right there, Trey. It's nothing like victory on a cold night. On Georgia Public Broadcasting.
This is such a huge win for Milton, a huge regular season win. And they've got two more games to go in the regular season. If they win just one of those games, they'll more than likely be in the postseason, where they have not won a postseason game since 1953. As McLeod hits a knee one more time, and we're down inside a minute. And you can feel the excitement build on the Milton side as they realize that they just picked up their biggest win of the season, and they just beat their rival Walton for the first time in 13 seasons.
That's awesome, man. You got to tell that story, man. You know, talked about, I have to bring this up, man. They spent so much time in the weight room. You look at these guys, we walked the sideline before the game. We saw how big they are, and they bring so much specimen to the physical game of football. And these guys won this football game on the defense side of the ball. I know they ran the ball well on offense, but this defense definitely stepped up. When they needed to play, they showed up. When they needed a fourth down stop, they showed up. They came back. And that's why they worked so hard in the weight room, because when the game is close, strength sometimes take over. And it took over tonight, Trey.
And look at the excitement build on the home sideline. A huge smile on the face of Coach D. Cristofaro. And you saw McLeod in there mixing it up. They're a happy group tonight. And there you see a great shot of Chad Toliver. And downstairs to John Nelson with the winning coach, Nelly.
All right, here with Coach D. How big a win was this?
Well, it was big for the region. We needed to win one after two losses, and kids played great tonight. First time we've beaten Walton since 1994, from what I understand. So it was a big win for the program.
Now, we're going to be talking to Chad in just a sec, and I know that he was put in there because of necessity, but talk about the running game in general, because you were getting thunder and lightning there tonight.
Well, I tell you what, between Miko and Chad, you know, Miko's the banger, and Chad's the guy that goes outside, and between the two of them just did a great job. Now, the O-line blocked their behinds off.
Congratulations. Go celebrate.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
All right. We'll have Chad Toliver in a bit.
Thank you very much, John Nelson. Milton has won the game tonight in a big Region 5 6A game, 28-21. First time since 1994 that Milton has defeated Walton. It's a hot time in Milton, Georgia tonight. Let's get right to the highlights and show you how this one went down tonight. Right off the bat, it was the Walton Raiders taking the lead. Number 14, quarterback Price Wilson. There's the play that sets it up, the long pass play down inside. And then from that point, he calls his own number. The Price is right as Price Wilson takes it in on a 14-yard run to make it 7-0, Walton on top. But on the ensuing kickoff, number 3, Chad Toliver hauls it in, and then he hauls Buggy. He goes 99 yards with this touchdown return to make it 7-7, tying the game up. Chad Toliver with just a huge game tonight. Now, Price Wilson rolling out, looking for somebody to throw to. He goes deep for this one. It's complete. Great catch. That would set up the touchdown right at the end of the first half as K.K. Brooks scores to make it 14-13. That was the halftime score. Now in the third quarter, it's Price William to Davis Pigeon. This gives Walton a 21-13 lead. But from that point on, Milton hitched up their britches and went to work. They score here on a 21-yard touchdown run by Chad Toliver. The two-point conversion makes it 21-21. And so we go to the fourth quarter. Here's a completed pass right there. That's the two-point conversion that made it 21-21. Here's your game winner, Chad Toliver, with his third touchdown of the game, makes it 28-21. And that is your final as Milton goes to 6-2 on the season. They snap a two-game losing streak. They win it by a touchdown, 28-21, over their region rivals, the Walton Raiders. Let's check in now with John Nelson with one of the stars of the game. John?
And I'll give you one guess as to who the star of the game was. All right, Chad, big night for you. Coming into tonight, what was the thoughts going through the team's mind knowing how big a game this was?
Oh, it was pretty big. We just knew we had to get back on streak. We lost two tough games, and we wanted to get back on streak. These guys are well coached. Coach told us that it's going to come down to whoever makes the least amount of mistakes, and we came out. The O-line was up great. They were pushing hard. They were giving me pretty big holes for me to run through, so I kind of made it look easy. I had the easy job. They had the hard job up front, and that was pretty much our motto of the week.
All right, so let's talk about let me go to the kickoff return real quick. It looked like everything just opened up for you. You broke a couple of tackles, but it looked like it was it as easy as it looked?
Absolutely. Well, Coach Allison, we work on it. We don't go off the field unless we have everything perfect, and all the other 10 guys, they blocked their butts off, and I was able to hit a seam, make a move, and go the rest of the way. But all 10 of the other guys, they made their blocks, and we work on it every day in practice, so we just had to come out here and execute it.
Now, let's talk about the remainder of the season here a little bit. You've got two more games left. Coming in, you knew what you had to do. What's the mindset of you guys right now getting this first hurdle out of the way?
Honestly, we just take one game at a time. We knew that, you know, it was a tough two losses that we had. We just had to come back. We had to play hard, and we got to take one play at a time, one game at a time, and just make sure we're playing for one another, and I think we'll finish out.
Running game, thunder and lightning. You talked about the offensive line, but you and Brisker were pounding it two different ways tonight.
Yeah, he's probably one of the strongest I've ever seen. Brisker, I mean, he does everything right, and he was able to wear him down. I'm not going to lie, I mean, he's 200 pounds running at you full speed, so I would hate for him, you know. But it was up line. You had Nick Wilson creating holes, you had Ernest Dye creating holes, you had our whole line just creating holes, and it made it look easy for us.
Nice to give credit for your O-line. Go celebrate, Chad.
Will do. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mark, best seat in the house is all yours. Beach is closed.
Big night for Chad Toliver. Big night for the Milton Eagles. They win it tonight over Walton, 28-21. Now, GPB will televise another terrific matchup next week. A rivalry in DeKalb County. A top-ranked and undefeated Tucker takes on the Lions of Martin Luther King. The all-access pregame show kicks off at 7 with the kickoff of the game at 7:30. And coming up right after I say goodnight tonight, an encore presentation of this game, Walton Milton. You can relive all the tackles, all the passes, all the touchdowns right after I say goodnight. So for all of us here at GPB, thanks for joining us on Football Fridays in Georgia. We have you covered every single Friday night all the way to the state championship games in the Georgia Dome in December. So until next week at Hallford Stadium in Clarkston, Georgia, I'm Mark Harmon. For all of us here at GPB Sports, thanks for watching. Have a great week, and so long, everybody. We'll be right back.